I was watching over vacation.
What?
This fucking Kathy Lee. You know, I want to leave her alone, but she won't let me.
She can't. You can't.
She will. She sucks me back
you
in.
You can't. If you watch her, you will just get drawn right back in.
I saw a thing over vacation. I've never seen anything like this. Kathy Lee now is on. And God bless her. I don't have anything against her. But she is really got to be the world's dumbest person.
What did she do?
She wants to be a good person. She's a Christian. She wants to be
well,
nice.
Well, yeah.
You know.
Well, that tells you right there that
right.
There's an evil inside.
Yeah, right. She's angry. So, I can't even describe. I'm going to attempt to describe to you the most disturbing television I've ever seen in my life.
All right.
And I want to like Kathy Lee.
No, you don't.
I do. I don't have anything against her, but she does horrible things. And people say I'm a monster. I would never do what she did on TV.
All right. What did she do?
Okay. I'm sitting and watching the television, and there she is, Kathy Lee. Okay. She announces that every week she wants to do bring out a Good Samaritan. She's soliciting letters from the audience. And did you see this?
No, but I can imagine what she did now.
You have no idea.
All right.
No, you don't. Whatever you're imagining, it's worse.
Okay.
You saw
this? Yes, I
did. You saw it. Did you have the reaction I did? You did. Okay. So listen to this.
She's soliciting from the audience for Good Samaritans.
Right. It's this regular segment on the Kathy Lee and Hoda show.
Yeah.
You know, last hour of the Today Show. Okay, that's fine. And Kathy Lee announces when she sees these Good Samaritans, she's going to write a song about them, and her friend is going to come out, an opera singer, and sing the beautiful song that she wrote. Okay? So I go, okay, let's see the Good Samaritan. Well, this mom comes out, and she says, my son, I wrote the letter, Kathy Lee. My son is a wonderful boy. He is a star athlete in high school. He's very handsome. He's very popular. He's football, lacrosse. He's going to Harvard. You know, he's the star of the school. Well, Kathy Lee, my son is so wonderful. He walks into the cafeteria. Now, my son is a senior, and he sees this kid sitting at one of the cafeteria tables all by himself. Every table is full except for one. It's as if
everybody has shunned him.
As if a stink bomb went off.
Yeah.
And my son went over to this boy. He's a sophomore, a 10th grader. He's a little kid.
His name is Howard.
Listen to this. They go, my son went over, and he sat down at the table and decided to be this kid's friend. And this is who I'm nominating. With that, Kathy Lee brings out the good-looking kid and this fucking mess of a kid from 10th grade who he befriended, who happens to be autistic.
Aww.
He's a little kid. He's a sweet boy.
Aww.
And they start praising this senior for what a wonderful guy he is. And then Kathy goes, you're wonderful. Can you imagine what it must be like to sit at the table alone? I wrote a song about it. And this opera singer comes out singing this song. What is it like to be alone sitting at the cafeteria table? No one will talk to you. This little kid.
This is the worst thing that could happen to you for doing something nice.
First of all, this was wrong on 50 different levels. Number one, why did the mom need to write a letter? Number two, now they've got this kid who's unpopular. Now they're singing about him.
Right.
The kid starts crying, the little chubby kid who has autism. And Kathy Lee, and instead of understanding why the kid's crying, Kathy Lee says, I've been doing this show for years. I always wonder why I do it. I do it because I can see my music moves people.
She thinks it's her.
Yeah. And the kid goes, no, this is so sad. She's singing about this kid's life. This was the train wreck of all time.
Wow.
Why does the mom need to brag about her son about this?
Well, it's one thing to brag about your son, but to shine a light on the problems of this other child
and
whose
now,
life has magnified
Robin,
his problems all of his life.
Now this kid's on national television as some loser.
Yeah.
Who he was finally being accepted. Some of the other kids are now accepting him. Now he's like the poster boy for being the sad,
being a
lonely
loser.
Kid.
Yeah.
I said, this is the most horrible thing you could do to a child. Child abuse. Mac, listen, I was one of those kids. Nobody wanted to sit with me. Imagine my mom brings me on TV.
Somebody singing about
it. Wait, I got the song. You got to hear this fucking song. And not only that, it is the world's worst fucking song.
Of
this Kathy
it is.
Lee
she
kid,
wrote it.
She wrote a horrible song. Listen to so picture the good-looking high school kid. And he should have said to his mother, Mom, I don't want to go on TV and brag about this. I did this because I did a nice thing.
Yeah, I was just moved.
Listen to this song. So now the chubby kid, the kid with autism is sitting there, this poor kid who I loved, and here's this god-awful song.
And now it's time for the song written just for the two of you and sung by the talented...
Just for the two of you.
...and beautiful Broadway performer Kate Baldwin. It's called All Alone.
Now the kid is crying during it. He's miserable.
We see the never- but too often look away from the
like he's a pariah. Right, we see
right,
them
right.
every day,
and
we too often
them.
Look away.
Unto yeah. our city alone. We seldom hear their voice because we make the choice to leave them right there all alone.
Can you imagine being on TV? You're the kid in high school no one wants to sit with.
It's a new event. I mean, she's just writing what happened.
Yeah. Oh.
It's not a song.
It's horrible. Not only is this horrible on the musical level, it's what they're doing to this little kid is just, I wanted to rip the television apart. I go, why can't I be on vacation and relax?
We choose to leave them alone.
We see them everywhere.
We see them like they're
everywhere,
monsters.
Everywhere, these monsters.
We see them everywhere. Kathy Lee, very moved by this.
Air, but too often we don't care.
We wonder if they have B.O.
In a world of our own, we rarely realize they're angels in disguise. So we leave them right there.
And the kid's like, I'm not an angel in disguise. I'm just a kid.
I want to be like everybody else.
Yeah. I can't believe we're on national television and fucking this old lady is singing a goddamn song about what a loser I am. My mom should have brought me on TV to be humiliated.
He called a monster.
These are angels disguised as monsters.
Can you imagine if hello?
And Kathy Lee is quelling.
Yes, because my music is moving.
And she thinks the kid's crying because he's moved by it.
He's crying about his life.
She goes, why are you crying? He goes, I'm sad.
Oh, was a word you'd never heard. Can you imagine if you'd never had a friend?
Ignore these hideous exteriors. Imagine being disgusting and never having anyone talk to you. You're a hideous little monster, but inside you're an angel. This fucking Kathy Lee must be out of her. She must be fucking. She must be insane.
I it looks like the kids are growing up okay in spite of her.
Who knows?
Or because of her, I don't know.
Who knows?
And so there must be something redeeming.
Maybe Frank's
about
her. A great parent.
Can you imagine if loneliness was all you'd ever known? It's more than we could ever comprehend.
And they got the kids sitting there.
Oh, I'm going to cry.
And the good-looking high school kid is sitting there, and his mom is all proud. And then the mom of the autistic kid is sitting there, and I'm like, why are you letting your son go through this? Have a heart.
All to be on TV.
Imagine him in a psychiatrist's office in about 10 years going, you're not going to believe this one. I'm like 15. I don't have friends. My mother schleps me out onto the Kathy Lee Gifford show.
So she can sing about it.
Right. So that she can make an opera song about my loneliness and what a loser I am and how no one will sit with me at the cafeteria table. Oh, my God. I'm watching. You saw it, Lisa. Did you sit there and have the same reaction I did?
Yeah, it happens weekly. And they did a behind-the-scenes
thing. But to a little boy?
I know.
But miracles can happen sometimes.
Miracles.
Do. And sometimes the miracle turns out to be you. You embrace a stranger and she'll love you.
I can't take it. Oh, and Kathy Lee's so proud of her song. The miracle is someone talks to you. The miracle happens. Someone talks to you. Holy shit. And imagine you're that kid and you're on TV. I would kill myself.
Well, you know, what's amazing to me is the song is really all about Kathy Lee.
Yeah.
Like, she's the kind of person who would walk past this kid every day.
Absolutely.
And never see him. And the miracle is there's somebody like that boy who actually goes over and sits there. Kathy is the one who's going to walk by you every day.
Here's the autistic kid. And like, so the afterwards, like, he's upset. You can see he has some tears in his eyes.
You know, we've been doing this now since October of last year, and every time I say to myself, gee, are we going to be able to capture it, you know? But I looked over, and there was Graham, and he was, he had tears in your eyes. Buddy, did you like your song?
Yeah, it was a little too sad.
And then they laugh at him.
Yeah. He's telling the truth. You really painted my life as a dismal failure.
The kid's autistic. He's trying to say, you know, that isn't my life, you fucking cunt. I wish I could be this kid's father. And I would take him. I said, Kathy Lee, you're not fucking putting my son on TV to fucking ridicule him. I want to write a song about Kathy Lee and go on that show.
Buddy, how'd you like your song,
how'd you like
buddy?
Him? Now I know why we do this show.
Buddy.
Buddy. And then they all laugh when he goes, it's a little too sad, because they realize they're fucking making him miserable.
Oh, they're nervous.
Well, David can go, you know, hey, all alone, yeah. Baby. Yeah, we'll jazz it up next time.
She's all happy about her song, All Alone. I tell you, it's unbelievable. Why doesn't she write a song about Frank when he was cheating?
Oh, no.
That
there
she
was nothing
write.
To sing about there.
No song for that?
That didn't inspire her to write.
Frank was dissatisfied with his love life. He went to a hotel to get anal from a stewardess.
And everyone's going, oh, a miracle happened.
But the miracle happened. She said no. She only gave him vaginal sex, you know. She tasted Frank's cum. That I know. It was wrong. But she never gave him anal. I mean, what the fuck?
And let her stand there while you sing.
Here's what I got out of it. The really popular kid now is even more popular because he's such a great guy.
Right, and the other kid's still alone.
He bukkakeed the stewardess. He wanted to come on his chest. I had to break the news to the kids about Frank. Frank. Imagine what it was like to be sitting next to Regis, and the whole world laughed at me. No wonder I like to have a drink or two. That stewardess was evil. She licked Frank's taint and fingered his asshole. And I knew. And Frank met me at Cipriani afterwards and acted like nothing happened. But he had just had sex in a hotel. This is bullshit. It really is. I'm sick of Frank. I could smell strange pussy on his lips. I could. Strange pussy on Frank's lips. His face shined with her juices. While I was home alone, imagine being alone at home with Frank and the pussy juice on his lips. How's my song?
Oh,
can I sing
moved.
It on TV?
Right.
Look at you, you're crying. Pussy juice on Frank's lips.
I think you captured it.
His penis was bruised from hard pelvic thrusting. And I knew. He came home that night. I said, why does Frank smell like tuna fish? It was the stank from that stewardess. Now, you get the idea.
Oh, God.
Nice
who
piano.
Is that woman warbling?
Ooh, that's my friend.
The two of them.
The wonderful. Who is it? The wonderful.
Kate Baldwin.
Who's that?
Oh, my goodness.
She's a Broadway singer.
And now it's time for the song written just for the two of you and sung by the talented and beautiful Broadway performer Kate Baldwin. It's called All Alone.
Yeah, great. Make sure to get a close-up on the autistic kid's face during this. Oh, my God.
How'd you like your song, buddy?
Imagine being an ugly little troll and no one wants to sit with you. How'd you like that song, buddy? That was great, Kathy Lee. Life should be very easy for me at school now.
You know, we've been doing this now since October of last year, and every time I say to myself, gee, are we going to be able to capture it, you know?
Yeah, you got it. You nailed it. Don't worry. You captured it, okay. You just wrecked this kid's life.
But I looked over.
Why don't you do that for Cassidy and Cody? The fuck is wrong with you?
Well, theirs would be a happy song.
Let's eliminate that segment. Hey, John, is that show doing well in the ratings? They got to cancel that.
It's been going on and on and on.
There's no public outcry over it. I mean, really? I'm watching this. I'm going, certainly they're going to receive a letter or two saying this wasn't right. It's a poor little kid. He's a cute kid. He's got autism. He's, you know, he's got issues. Doesn't have any friends. And Kathy Lee's highlighting his plight.
It doesn't do well, but it does well enough to stay on the air.
So what's the rating on that?
It gets around like a one.
A one?
If that.
Well, I remember the days when you had a one, they threw you off television. Larry King sitting there going, I had a one. What'd I take me off for? I mean, did you see this?
Yeah.
You saw the segment too?
We were just watching it in the back.
Did you believe it?
No.
Watch it. Go. How do you get that segment? On YouTube?
Jason had it online. I guess.
How do you get it?
Go to NBC.com's website.
Go to this.
They haven't taken that down.
It's still up.
And watch it, because how do you get that, JD? And say it slowly.
com. You can put in everyone has a story in Google. It's on Kathy Lee Gifford's website, too. They post all the everyone has a story.
What is her website? Kathy Lee Gifford?
Yeah, KathyLeeGifford.com.
It is?
Did I say that slow enough?
Is that really her website?
I think so, yeah.
She has her own website with that on it?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I never saw a TV segment. I said, this is like child abuse. And I can't believe, you know what, no one must be watching this thing, because if anybody watched it, they'd say, listen.
There would be an outcry.
Someone ought to sit this woman down and explain to her that this is not a good thing.
The Autism Council didn't jump on that?
I mean, imagine sitting by yourself and what a fucking loser you are. I mean, what is that?
There was Graham, and he was, mm-hmm. He had tears in your eyes, buddy. Did you?
I encourage all of you to talk to an ugly kid today.
Like your song?
Yeah, it was a little too sad.
Davidson got, you know, hey, all alone, baby. Yeah, we'll jazz it up next time.
Oh, she talks to kids so well. She really knew how to make them feel better. Oh, that's all right. If it's too sad, we can jazz up my wonderful song. All alone at the lunch table. No one will talk to me and alone. All right, that's some song. I don't know.
If you'd like, I can force Cody to be your friend. This would be good for Cody to do, to make friends with all the losers. I'm going to talk to Cody and Cassidy about being friends.
I never thought of talking to losers. What a great idea.
I should have done that in high school. I think every week we should bring out another loser.
And I can write a song for them.
What a wonderful way to be highlighted. It would probably take me 50 years of therapy to get over it. Think I feel used? Oh, my God, no empathy whatsoever. And yet she thinks she's doing a good thing. God love her. I get sucked into... I should not watch that show. I got sucked into the Kathy...
That's right. You'll get into that vortex of Kathy Lee.
Beth is to blame. Because I walk by the TV, I see her watching. And then I get all worked up. She goes, you're so angry. I go, yes. Fuck. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. I'm not, right?
No. I'm telling you, she's writing it from the standpoint of a person who would never walk over to anybody like that kid.
If I'd done that in high school, I probably would have gotten an award.
But it wouldn't have occurred to her. She's like, hey, most of the time, she's writing a... This is her song. I'm the person who would never walk over. But sometimes there's a miracle.
You think Frank would walk over?
I never think about anyone but myself, but every once in a while there's a miracle like this kid over here who walks over.
Frank would walk over if it was a hot stewardess.
Well, but he's not walking over to the autistic kid.
I don't blame Frank for trying to get a little strange. I couldn't take her either.
No, he's getting strange all the time. He was looking for normal.
Right. It's as strange as you can get.
Frank, you're not going to believe it. I wrote a song about a wonderful autistic child today, about how a wonderful boy walked by him and sat at his cafeteria table. Good.
Oh, Jesus, I need a blowjob.
I need some normal.
I wonder what that stewardess is doing here.
Man, I was like, wow. All right, you know what, though? What the fuck? I can't correct all the things that are wrong in the world. And you know, who am I to pass judgment? I don't know. I really do want to like Kathy Lee. I don't want to be her critic.
I know that you're trying to be a better human being and
I am.
You don't want to harbor any resentment or ill will towards others.
But this is outrageous. I couldn't sit quietly by. What?
Do you want to hear a song? Do you want to hear the song that Kathy Lee wrote about Frank, her husband, about the whole affair?
Oh, she did?
She wrote like 10 years ago.
What?
JD1 in Purple.
I didn't know there was a song.
It's called Only My Pillow Knows.
Oh, wow. I do remember this.
Every one of her songs kind of sounds the same, no offense.
Oh, yeah. She knows one, too.
There is no distance so close as to lovers. Face to face, skin against skin.
Ugh. I'm going to throw up already. So Kathy Lee's a lover of Frank's, and Frank went out trying to get some pussy from a stewardess. How come she wasn't literal about this song? Her other song is very literal.
Right, right.
This one's kind of disguised.
There is no pleasure so deep as together they breathe, letting no one else in. Now there's no distance so great.
I do want to like Kathy Lee because they even had Beth on that show.
I know Beth goes on the show.
And I know Hoda. She's lovely.
Yes, I've met Hoda.
Yeah. I want to be friends with people, too. I don't always want to be the critic. I always don't want to be the fly in the ointment. Kathy Lee likes Beth. Hoda likes Beth. I like Hoda. But I can't sit by when I see this shit. I don't know. There's something in me that just won't give up. Someone's got to tell her it's wrong.
And nobody else is going to do that but you.
That's my role in life. Everyone else shuts their mouth.
There's two people in the same day.
That's why I liked Kelly when she replaced Kathy Lee. She doesn't write songs about fucking kids with autism.
No.
You know, she just sits there and she does some banter with Regis, and it's very lovely and funny and sweet, and she looks good. And perfect. I got no problem. Kathy Lee just does the wrong thing, and I have to correct her. It's my job.
Let me hear more of this song. I'm waiting to get to the part where he's in the room with the stewardess.
Yeah, you'll hear that. Only my pillow knows. This is very cryptic.
There is no chasm so steep as betrayal.
Oh, there we go.
No damage so deep to a heart. Where did the love go?
Right. How did he still loves you, just like fucking other chicks.
We outgrow the oneness that came with the dawn.
He said, dude, he's an ex-jock.
Stop giving him excuses? I'm trying to hear what she's saying.
Why did he want my asshole? He wanted his stewardess's asshole. What's wrong with my asshole? Should have been the song. What's wrong with my asshole? My stinky little asshole.
He never asked me.
I guess there's no bigger betrayal than when your husband wants a woman's asshole and it's not yours. There's no bigger betrayal when he asks for her asshole and not mine. It's such another pity that he's sucking another woman's titty, but not mine. Frank tried my asshole one night. My God, he was covered with mud. It didn't work out just right. I guess this stewardess understands his light. I guess there was no mud on the turtle. She must have been so fertile with Frank. Right now I'm lying here alone. He's there with her, coming on her back. And I'm writing this song and it's really crap. Oh my. Want to get back to Only My Pillow Now?
Yeah.
Creating the thing. Who had the thirst to move on?
Who had the what?
The thirst.
He had the thirst.
Who?
I'm thirsty, Kathy.
Frank had the thirst.
Hey, Kathy, don't blame us. I mean, you wrote this. What's wrong with my bud? He's fucking some other slut.
Go ask the willow.
Go ask the willow.
Know.
I wouldn't ask the willow. I'd go ask a marriage counselor. At the very least a divorce attorney like Dominic. Go ask the willow. why there's no shit on my pillow.
But only my pillow.
Ah, big deal.
The pillow knows.
Pillow's cheating on her, too.
Well, she's crying and telling the pillow things. You guys don't get it.
No,
I understand.
She's asking all these questions. The pillow has the answers?
No, I think actually the pillow from the hotel room has the answers. Only that pillow knows. What's up?
You know, Jason and I were just looking on Amazon. Do you know how many CDs? Can you guess how many CDs she has? Kathy Lee has
I'm
available?
I'm going to say she's an egomaniac.
It's not as bad as you
think. I'm going to say 23.
I'll say 12.
10.
10, huh?
What, have you heard of any? Can
no.
You, like, I mean...
Only when she goes on Larry King to promote.
I think they're all... The other thing is I think they're all on her own label.
Of course. Who else is going to...
There's no label good enough for those songs. I got to take a break. Anyway, I didn't mean to spend so long on that. But...
Oh, my God. That's, you know, this is the first Kathy Lee segment in a long time.
It feels good to talk about Kathy again. She hates me.
Can't imagine why.
I don't know. How do you let something like that go? It was by chance I walked by the TV. I truly don't watch that show that much. And, you know, I couldn't believe my eyes, my ears, or anything else.
It was like a train wreck. You couldn't take your eyes off.
What kills me is, like, I'm perceived as a bad person. I would never, I swear to you, in my right mind, bring an autistic child who's had difficulty meeting people on my show and sit there and say, look what a loser you are, and here's the guy who's willing to talk to you.
Right.
And then write songs about it. I wouldn't. Maybe I should.
Don't we?
Maybe we do.
I mean, what else do we do?
No, we make fun of people outright. We don't disguise it.
Yeah, we don't disguise it, but right. We do bring out the fact that, you know, people are having these miserable lives and are shunned by others.
We just don't write songs about it. Well, at least we're as bad as Kathy Lee.
Well, you know what that is? She thinks of herself as a good person, and she's just like us.
Right.
That's what it is.
There's the angle. We're as bad as her, but she thinks she's better than us. Why don't we have, here's a new contest. We want to have fattest, ugliest junior high kid contest. No one will sit without a table. What do you think?
Nominate the biggest nerd from your school.
There
the
you
one
go.
That nobody will be with.
You know what? I wouldn't even do that.
I know. That's a horrible contest.
All right. Well, anyway, to that kid out there, I love you. And hang in there. Things do get better. I'm proof of that. Believe me. No one wanted to sit with me either. Trust me. All right. We'll take a break and we'll be back right after these words.
During the commercial, I was just enjoying some Kathy Lee Gifford music.
I haven't heard any of this.
Oh, you gotta get into it.
Are you putting this in your car CD player?
Yeah, best album of the year. What's her problem? What, how old is she? Is she our age?
Yes.
And this is what she's into? Well, there's a lot
she's in that time warp.
Yeah.
When I was just a little girl, asked my daddy, what will I be?
You'll be an obnoxious bim.
Did he give you an answer?
I asked my daddy what I'll be. I'll sit next to Regis like a puppet. Ah. Yeah. Two.
Will I be pretty? Will I be
yes. Safe? Yep, you will. You'll marry Frank Gifford. Get all his money. You will be pretty. Yes, that's true. You'll be rich. You'll marry an old guy. The GIF. Although his funds will be depleted somewhat after his other marriages. How many other marriages are we looking at?
I think she's his third wife.
I see. Plus, she's got a whole slew of kids, I guess, from the other marriages.
Yeah, I guess you'll have to split that fortune up a lot.
Yeah. I can't listen to her sing, because in the background, I hear her head whistling as she she sings.
Here's what he said to me.
Que sera, sera.
Whatever will be, will be.
Is she a Lawrence Welk singer?
Yeah, she's got the Lennon sisters behind her.
The future's not ours to see. Que sera.
Do you think the record company... What record company released this?
Kathy Lee Gifford Records.
Let's see. Warner Brothers. Hey, listen.
Are you kidding? It's Warner Brothers?
Yeah, she's got a lot of fans. She's on, you know, she's on that show at Regis.
It's mail order. No label would touch this.
Oh, it says Warner Brothers.
Is it? It's mail order, though.
Oh, Warner Special Products.
Right. Very special.
Oh, it's mail order.
Yeah. It's like Special Olympics.
It's Special Olympics. Yeah, it's not
special
a real...
Special Records, Special Olympics.
It's not a real record.
It's like the short school bus class. I said, you know, this song was crying out for a remake.
Yeah, this needed to be done again. Doris Day's version wasn't enough.
That's right. When I grew up and fell in love,
Elijah Head is divorced because evidently you had sexual problems with your first husband, according to your book, and then you married an old man. That's what Elijah Head
is. Another marriage.
Yeah.
Will we have rainbows day after day? Here's what my sweetheart said.
No, he said, get out.
Que sera, sera. I'll tell you one thing. I wouldn't have any sexual problems with her.
Well, how do you know?
I'd chain her to the bed, treat her like a dog. That's what I would do to her. And she'd love it. She would love it. She'd be my dog. I wouldn't even call her by her human name. She'd have
her
a dog name. What's her? What would I name her as a dog, you think?
Yeah, what would be her dog name?
Do you think that's a little personal between me and Kathy Lee?
I think you should share it with us. She shares everything.
It'd be great when Regis is sick and stuff. I'd have to go on and host the show with Kathy Lee, and I'd share with the audience her dog name. It's Fido Lee. Dido. Oh, that's a really good song. She's a big talent.
Any other songs on this album?
Sure. Well, you could hear Sentimental Journey, Smile, Hey There, The Very Thought of You. I don't know one of these songs.
Oh, you know all of them.
Sentimental Journey, I know. If I Give My Heart to You, Don't Get Around Much Anymore, Over the Rainbow.
Over the Rainbow, let's hear that.
You mean, you want to hear her?
Judy Garland classic.
You want to hear a Butcher, a Judy Garland song? Okay, Over the Rainbow, number 7. I love CDs. Oh, we got to play this one.
What?
My Lap is a Tuna Boat. I never heard that before.
That's a new one.
Oh, what a super talent.
In a lullaby.
And Toto just ran in front of a bus.
You think she did this so she'd have something to play around the house?
Yeah. Call you not to be still with your moron.
That you dare.
I hear ya.
Really do come to.
This might have been what stopped Regis' heart.
Yeah.
And wait where the clouds all fall behind.
All right, very good.
Nah.
Somewhere the munchkins are drowning themselves in teacups as they listen to this. Hey, where is that imbecile Scott? I want to play the bit.
Here.
We have recorded yesterday. We made a movie for you this morning. We're all anxious to hear it. It's called Just Barely Alive. It stars Robin Quivers, myself, Fred Norris, Jackie Joneman Montley,
Gary Delabate.
Gary Delabate, Scott the Engineer, Tom Cipisano, our general manager. We're all in it. Very
Ba-ba-boom.
Excited by it. But that imbecile can't seem to get it here. Let's call Scott.
See where we're at. Progress is. That didn't even ring, did it?
Yeah, I don't know how to call down there. You think it's easy, right?
Production.
Hello?
Production.
Hey.
Hey.
It's Howard.
What's that?
We're on the air. It's Howard.
Hey, Howard. How's it going?
Put me on with Scott.
All right, man.
That's a little bit of the movie in the background. You can hear Scott editing.
Sorry, we overheard your head. You all right, Tom?
Howard, you're on the air.
Hello?
What's going on with the movie?
The movie's almost done.
Seriously, come on, Scott.
No, it is.
I want it now.
It's not ready now.
When will it be ready?
It will be ready.
I'll do a commercial break. Will you be done with it after the commercial break?
Yeah, no.
Oh, man. Scott, wait a second. You got in at 4:30. You've been working on it for 2 hours.
This is the best.
What?
This is the best bit we've ever done.
Yeah, but so what? I need it now. What good is it if you're the only one hearing it?
You're enjoying it.
I love it. It's great.
4:30, 5:30, 6:30, 7:30. How many hours is that?
That's three hours.
All right, and then yesterday he had it all edited. What time were you here till yesterday working on it?
Three.
How many hours? Three?
Three.
So 7 hours to put together a 5-minute bit. That's unbelievable.
Well, wait till you hear it. You'll say
it's unbelievable to me that he doesn't know how to put together a bit any quicker than that.
Scott, you told us in a half an hour it would be done. We've been waiting.
Yeah. I had trouble locating some very tricky effects.
All right, very good, thank you.
You mean he still had to look for things to put in it?
Yeah, sure. Why are you talking to me instead of working?
I don't know, you...
All right, let me we'll get that on very soon. I know everyone's looking forward to it. You know, I work on these things all afternoon, and then I can't even get them. If I put it together myself, I could do it in an hour. I know it. And do it just as good. Maybe be a little worse, okay? But so what?
would we be able to notice the difference?
No, you wouldn't know the difference. Maybe you would, but the audience wouldn't.
Sitting here looking at the cover of USA Weekend. You know, that's USA Today's Weekend edition, the magazine. Did you see this?
No.
Kathy Lee hugging a black baby. I think she thinks she's running for president. And she's got this look on her face, this sad look on her face, because she's hugging a black baby. Maybe it's like an AIDS baby or something.
I think she usually hangs out with AIDS babies.
Let's see. Gifford at her shelter for babies with special needs. And look at the look. Oh, such a helpful.
Oh, I'm so touched.
With all the nails done and the gold watch and the, you know, and look at the nails.
The perfect hair, the makeup in place.
Yeah, and the huge friggin' diamond. And almost,
I'm sure she did a lot of work over at the shelter.
Yeah, and the tears in her eyes. Look. Oh, is she a freak?
Change the world.
Yeah, from Connecticut, change the world.
Yeah.
Yeah, from my retreat.
Sell the watch, feed the kids. She's so proud of her. You know, she's so proud of her charity work. Cody House and Gifford House.
Well, you know, all the kid needed was a hug from Kathy Lee.
Yeah.
Now he's fine.
Yeah. Let's see. Let me see if it's anything in the inside here. Oh, is she a fake? I mean, it's just like... I don't know. Some weird marketing campaign to get her to be like Miss America. Oh, here she is. On Make a Difference Day. And here she is surrounded by black babies. Babies with AIDS. And she's like... She's so perfectly groomed, it's sickening.
Right. Well, they need to be... the pretty white woman, and they'll feel better.
Go to a facility and rock a child.
I mean, it doesn't hurt your nails.
Yeah.
Not on a nail bed.
Yeah. She's the Mother Teresa of TV.
Mm.
Look at that face, the plus she puts on the cover.
Well, you know, whenever she does that children's variety thing, that's the same push.
Change the world.
Applehead.
I like the year that Cousin Brucey started crying first, so she couldn't cry.
I promised I wasn't going to cry.
No, Cousin Lee. This is your Cousin Brucey. Let me just say something here. I don't want to get this out of my way. I want to get off my chest. I don't want to get off my wig. Hey, listen to me, Cousin Lee. Yeah, I promise you, Jerry. I promise I wasn't going to cry. Here's your Cousin Brucey.
That ruined her crying gig.
This guy made a whole career being Cousin Brucey. Actually, just calling himself Cousin Brucey. That was his whole gig.
That's it.
Here's your Cousin Brucey. Hey, you know, Cousin, you know, all during the year, Cousin Brucey goes out and, you know, he makes a living and he makes appearance, Chuck E. Cheese and all these different places. Hey, I gotta tell you something. Once a year, I love to be here at the Children's Variety. Yeah, because, you know, it feels good to give something back to the people who made you something.
I want all my cousins out there to call in.
Give all my cousins.
And make pledge.
You know, during the year, you meet so many nice people, and I don't ask anything. Cousin Brucey doesn't ask anything about his fans. But I gotta tell you,
like, there's an actual Cousin Brucey fan somewhere. You know,
and Cousin Brucey goes out and he meets, he always refers to himself as Cousin Brucey.
Yeah.
Cousin Brucey goes out and meets all kinds of different people. And Cousin Brucey. Cousin Brucey loves everybody, but you know, during the year, there's a lot of times you feel you should be doing something and you don't get a chance. You don't get a chance. You know, there's a lot of days, Cousin Brucey, listen, we all have our bad days. I'm not saying no, you know, Cousin Brucey yells at people, and sometimes one time I remember I was on the air and my toupee came off of my headphones, and you know, really, and Cousin Brucey lost it and yelled at his engineer and yelled at the guy who makes his toupees because he's not supposed to really glue those things on tight on my head so that my headphones shouldn't be attached to my wig. But you know, it was the day I woke up, I put my wig on backwards, and your Cousin Brucey was a mess because nobody told his wife, didn't tell him his wig was on backwards, let him leave the house. And I remember I was making an appearance at Chuck E. Cheese, And I went down there, and all the kids were laughing at me. So, you know, Cousin Brucey has a bad tire, too. So, all the times, you forget all that. When you see tapes like we're running today on Children's Variety, see these kids, they got the A's, they got everything, and your Cousin Brucey want to help them. And perhaps I wouldn't cry, but...
Run over to Kathy Lee.
Yeah, I'm going
to
wipe my... Does anyone have a tissue said this is my toupee? Oh, Jesus.
Because the move is you get so broken up, you can't talk, and you have to throw it to the other co-anchor.
I'm going
to
throw it to Kathy Lee.
It's all right, Brucey.
You know, I love the kids. I can't talk to Kathy Lee. You are one phony bitch. Go ahead.
Kathy Lee Gifford with Family Values. Meanwhile, the guy she's married to has been has dumped two women.
Yeah.
And entire families.
He thinks they're very valuable.
Yeah.
I saw one of those cruise commercials that she does again, and Frank's in it. And, you know, Frank's laying there like Weekend at Bernie.
I know.
And doesn't he look relaxed?
They have Kathy Lee and all the... I saw it last night, too. What were you watching?
Oh, some news show.
Entertainment Tonight?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was watching that, too. And I was on the phone since... I was on the phone here till about 1 o'clock. I went home, and I was on the phone till about literally 6:30. And then I guess around 7:30, I finally got some TV on. I said, I'm going to lay down in bed and relax and try to, you know, wind down here. I turn on, and the first thing I see is Kathy Lee Gifford and her Carnival Cruise commercial.
Right.
And so that comes on, and Giff, who appears to really have the mobility of a dead person, is propped up in different chairs or laying actually horizontally. He's actually flat on his back in a chaise lounge through the whole commercial. And Kathy Lee is full of pep and energy.
She's dancing and whirling and singing.
And it is like Weekend at Bernie's because Kathy Lee is doing all this movement around, you know, Frank Gifford.
Yeah.
And Gifford just lays there. I mean, you know, the pallbearers are out of the shot. They're just completely like, they're right out of the frame.
I thought it was so funny when she says, doesn't Frank look relaxed? Is this Weekend at Bernie's?
No, Frank looks dead. The only thing missing is the IV and the heart monitor. And so Frank's laying there and she goes, guess what, Frank? And she's in a mini dress and she got white silk stockings on. It's like a whole deal.
Yeah.
She got halter tops on. She's a magnificent looking creature. And yeah, it's an entire waist. And you know that like she needs a good workout. And I don't buy any of this religious crap.
She needs some harvesting.
Yeah. And Frank is laying there like, you know, Grandpappy Amos, you know, with his young broad. And he's laying flat on his back. And did you see one of the shots before Frank's on his back, he's going down the water slide with his shirt off, and he's like, he's got big breasts, and he's got that flabby belly, and he's going down the water slide. And it's like, look at Frank. Frank actually has mobility.
And how did he put Frank on the water slide?
And even going down the water slide, he looks like a dead guy being, like, slid down a slide.
Right.
It's like Burial at Sea.
The arms are flat, you know, flat at the sides.
Yeah.
No movement.
Yeah, it's Burial at Sea. Yeah, right. Yeah, just throw him over. Get an American flag and throw him overboard.
That's right. They forgot to wrap him. That was the only thing.
And then Frank is doing other stuff. They have him like, they have Frank. It's basically Frank doing some stuff.
Right, and she's dancing around it.
Yeah, this constant moving from Kathy Lee to make it appear that Frank Gifford is moving. I mean, Gifford, you know, at the end shot is that he's laying on this chaise lounge in a what appears to be how someone lays in their casket. Yeah, and then
the arms are folded across his chest.
Yeah, and he's wearing his polo, and Kathy Lee's got him all dressed up in his polo shirt, and you know, those little alligator shirts.
It looks like he's in Garanimals, actually. It looks like he was dressed by someone.
And he has, like, sailing pants on.
Yeah.
And nice shoes. He's laying there, and it looks freezing because the wind is blowing. The taxidermist just finished on him. And who buys those commercials? I mean, and why do they do those commercials? Aren't they as rich as they need to be? I mean, what did you say? You know, Carnival Cruise calls you and says, hey, we want you to do a series of commercials. You know, and we'll pay, I guess they pay him like, I don't know, $50,000, $75,000, whatever it is. I don't know what extraordinary amount of money to just shoot that thing for a day.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's
a whole endorsement deal where she gets paid a lot of money. Yeah, I don't know.
Maybe it's $500,000. But these are people who probably have $50 million.
They are not working to improve their lifestyle.
So wouldn't you say, you know, instead of going on and making jackasses out of herself, I mean, Frank is in his waning years.
And dragging Frank out.
Yeah, and shouldn't be in a bathing suit. You know, and really it's demeaning, you know, to see an old man sliding down a child's water slide. You know, like maybe it's time that we
Frank
just...
Frank could get hurt.
I feel like maybe we should turn this one down.
Yeah.
Like maybe we'll have some dignity.
Frank has to go get his proctology exam.
Yeah.
He's going down a water
slide. This is a man who goes for a colonoctomy every 3 months.
Ooh, sliding to the doctor.
So, he's laying there on that chaise lounge. I was freaking out last night because he gets me angry. He's laying on the chaise lounge, and this beautiful piece of ass is wrapped around him. Because whatever you think about Kathy Lee Gifford being vapid and just extraordinarily empty-headed and sort of like full of cliches, you know, oh, Cody watches Bible tapes every day. I don't want him watching regular television. You know, meanwhile, I hope he grows up to be a demon from all his Bible, you know, tapes. But, you know...
Maybe he'll grow up to be David Koresh.
As sickening as she is, the reason she's popular, she's an extraordinarily good-looking woman. Her legs are... I'd love to just... You talk about kissing someone all over their body.
You'd like to worship
her.
Oh,
I would just love to just work her over and to see her moaning and doing things like a dog all over that bed. Like, instead of, like, you know, all her Bible tapes and everything else, and then she's like, you know, no. Do it in a bad place. Do it in a bad place. And, you know, just to see that, it would be extraordinary. It would be extraordinary. So, you know. Those skinny legs, and she's got heels on, and she's all wrapped around Frank Gifford, like a young girl's wrapped around her dad or grandpa.
Right, it's like she took her father with her on this vacation.
And she's like, guess what, Frank? Good news. What is it, honey? And he can barely talk. He's like, what is it, honey?
It's like somebody's working him.
Yeah.
Like another puppet. Voice.
Blink once if you understand me.
Yeah, right. BJ. Kiff, guess what? You don't have to get up to that chaise lounge for another week. In fact, we can do your colonectomy right from the chaise lounge. We've cut a hole in the bottom of it. The doctor can get access to your buttocks.
The captain is coming with the enema bucket.
Yeah.
The only thing that changes is the expression on his face.
Yeah. Sweet doggy. And she says, oh, guess what, Gif? We're staying.
We've booked another week or something like
and
that.
And he's like, oh. You know, like, I mean, what they don't show you is you're surrounded by about 10,000 other people. Aren't those carnival cruises, like, packed to the gills?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Everybody looking for Frank and Kathy Lee.
Yeah, that carnival cruise looks hideous. I mean, it looks hideous. That one shot where she goes, the other one where she's with Willard Scott.
Yeah.
And it looks like a crowded dining room.
Yeah, it looks like you can't move.
Yeah, like people piled on top of people in water.
Mm-hmm. And you can't get out. There's no way to get out. You have to stay there with those people.
You're trapped on this water with every piece of trash that saw these. You know who's showing up.
Oh, yeah.
I'm taking the carnival cruise.
Oh.
Hey. Same one Kathy Lee's on. It's all the white trash. Some cruise.
Ma and Pa Kettle.
Cruise to hell.
In the next cabin.
Yeah.
Great Scott, Willard.
Great Scott, Willard. What are you doing here? I'm doing the same thing here.
Same as you, Kathy Lee. Picking up an easy payday. Pretending to like being here with everybody. Pretending.
Same as you.
7 days of pretend.
When this shoot's over, I'm getting out of here.
Easy pickings.
So.
Richard Simmons, what are you doing here?
I'm getting spanked. Daddy's been a bad boy. And so she's wrapped around Gif, and they're having the time of their lives, you know, and Gif's like, wow, another week. She doesn't even look that excited when she says, let's stay another week.
He's not a good actor.
No. He doesn't seem all that thrilled. Can we go?
Actually,
well, we're going to be here another week. Where are we?
I think Bernie had more expressions than Frank.
Yeah. Frank Gifford in Weekend at Bernie's 3. Drag him around. That would be funny. I would cast that movie in a minute. I would make that movie. I put up my own money.
It'd be great.
Frank Gifford as Weekend at Bernie's.
On a cruise.
Yeah, with Kathy Lee, and he dies, and she can't bear to see him go, and she's still bringing him to parties at Regis's house.
She thinks that he likes her singing because he doesn't, you know, he just sits there placidly.
Yeah, I saw an interview with him where he said that Kathy Lee's one of the smartest women he ever met.
At this point.
Yeah.
Now that he's losing brain cells.
Yeah, really.
He's not far behind Reagan, probably.
Well, I thought he was all there. Because, you know, he still does Monday Night Football and stuff. But when I heard him say that, I questioned.
Well, I remember the, you know, Billy talks about her singing. I remember the interview where she sat on the porch and sang to Geff. And he had to sit there smiling while she was singing.
That's always a weird move when, you know, you've got a schmaltzy spouse like that. And they have to sing to you. And you have to figure out what to do while they're singing. So stupid.
Yeah,
I'd be so embarrassed.
She liked it in her courting phase.
Yeah.
But after a few years, every morning, in the evening, get up!
There's public displays of affection, you know? Like, what do you do when you have some nutty broad singing to you?
Yeah.
Even though it's your wife and you're really into it, she's young and hot and everything, but it's like...
Yeah, I mean, if you were at home, you'd be putting your hands up her dress.
Right. Yeah. There's a camera on you, and you got to sit there with a big dumb smile on your face and keep staring at it. Yeah.
What a trade-off.
I know it's weird, even when we have rock stars in here and they start singing for us.
Yeah.
And they look over at me, and I look away because it's like it's embarrassing to watch somebody sing.
Yeah.
I don't want to have anyone singing to me.
Especially not Steven Tyler.
Yeah. Right. If I was a chick, I'd want that. All right, we're going to take a break, and we'll be back right after these words.
You're listening to The Howard Stern Show.
Do you want to hear tape of Kathy Lee on Rosie O'Donnell?
Yes. She was on yesterday.
Right.
What's she up to now?
I don't know. Let me just hear it. I just had them pull some clips.
But you know what? I think it's Katie Kirk who said to me someday, are you worried if it's not a creative or not a critical or not a commercial success? I go, you know what? I've had all of that.
Yeah.
And it's been wonderful, but it's not about that anymore in my life. It's about having the opportunities to do something you've never, ever...
I think they asked her about her record album. You said to her, do you care if the record is successful or not? Which, by the way, tanked.
Right. Nobody knows which way it's going.
Yeah, she knows it. And she goes, it's not about that. I've had all the success.
Yeah, now she wants to fail.
Now she's failing.
Let's go out and fail.
I don't care if I'm in the 99-cent bin a week after the album's released. I don't care that it says in the newspaper 89 cents for the Kathy Lee CD. You realize they're selling that thing for 89 cents that it costs more to produce? How much does it cost, Jackie, just to make one CD? $1.
Probably for her, she probably has a huge record company,
so it could
be
50 cents. All right, so the
profit.
So after all is said and done, if she's lucky, she's breaking even on 89 cents. 89 cents.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's not even selling for 89 cents.
The only thing that's the reason to be embarrassed is not if it doesn't sell. The only reason to be embarrassed is if it's a lousy record.
Well, be embarrassed.
It's a really good record, and I worked with amazing producers and writers, and I'm so happy to have had the experience.
And how does it feel to do, like, a big Faith Hill Britney Spears video?
It feels damn good, baby.
Does it?
She protests way too much. I don't care that Regis's ratings are skyrocketing without me. You don't understand. It's not about that. It's not about the fact that my record's in the 89-cent bin.
Yeah, she made a record not to sell.
I don't care
that
Regis and Gelman tell the world what a jerk I am behind my back. I don't care. I don't care that they won't let me back on the show to promote.
I don't care that they took down my picture.
I don't care that people are bad-mouthing me now. I don't care that Frank banged a stewardess who's slightly overweight with big cow breasts. It's not about that.
I don't care that I left the show to spend more time with my husband and me sleeping.
Right. I don't care. I don't care. Do you understand that I don't care? Now, here's a clip. Rosie and Kathy Lee talking about playing a drug whore in her new movie.
Oh, yeah, remember? That was the one where they had to teach her how to smoke pot. Right.
Now, this movie role, I gotta say, when I heard, you know, drug addict, loose woman, Kathy Lee Gifford, natural choice.
Poor Rosie, no wonder she wants to get out of the business. I have to sit there and interview Kathy Lee about some TV movie of the week that no one's gonna see. It's gonna be on E!
I don't care.
I don't care that it's on E! I don't care. It's not about that. I've done all that.
Well, when they called you, you read the script. What did you think?
I thought...
Boy, Rosie's voice can cut through steel, huh? I wouldn't want to be her lesbian lover and have her yelling at me. You did what? The kids call you what? Ema? No, I'm mommy. I'm the mommy. You're not mommy. You have to come up with another name.
I have to do this part. Really? All you hear about is how there are no great parts written for women of maturity.
Right.
This role has absolutely everything. My friend Mark Solomon wrote the script, not with me in mind at all, and I want to put this to rest. No, not at all based on any particular person.
Yeah, because I read it was based...
Yeah, there's a lot of controversy around
it. What's it supposed to be based on?
She is insane.
Everybody's talking about Kathy.
You're right.
On Brett Butler, it's not. It's not based on Brett or Roseanne or.
It's Rhett Butler, isn't it? Brett. Oh, it's Brett Butler? Is it Brett?
Anybody else. It's fiction. It could be about any of us because there's a little Amanda Berkeley in it, one of us.
It's not about Rhett Butler. It's not about making a film even that people will watch. Who cares if they watch it? As long as Jesus Christ watches it, I don't care. It's not about that.
And by the way, I'm not religious. I'm spiritual.
I like that. I like how she says, you know, she's insane. It's despite all the controversy, it's not about any particular person. What controversy?
Had you noticed? Was there a clamor? Did you hear a buzz about this?
Kathy Lee is talking about her image and how she doesn't care about it. Oh,
oh my gosh, she doesn't care again.
I don't care. You know when someone says they don't care, they care?
They care a lot.
It's just a total departure. Why play yourself?
Right.
That's not why you become an actress.
But you didn't think for a moment, wow, this is really playing against my image. I better...
I don't think about my image. If I thought about my image, I would have slit my wrist 20 years ago.
Oh, see. Slit her wrist.
20 years
ago. One can only pray. You're right.
I think about what I want to do as a performer. And
oh, performer. Now she's a performer. She used to read the weather on Good Morning America and Regis let her talk.
An entertainer.
Now she became an entertainer.
I wouldn't have done Broadway if I thought about it. That's ridiculous. And first of all, that's somebody else's.
I wouldn't have done Broadway if I thought about it. You mean you didn't put any thought
in?
and then what does that got to do with her image?
Not your opinion of yourself.
That's true.
And I'm not the least bit interested in repeating myself over and over and over again. I want to grow.
Now,
this woman, woo, do I grow? Woo!
Now, where is it playing? When is it on?
It'll be on the E Channel. Right after the Oscars.
Right after Howard Stern.
Right after the Oscars? Don't they go on all night?
Mandel, the adorable, delicious Howie Mandel, plays my long-suffering manager.
Right.
And he's the one that has to put out...
Delicious. What's with her?
Everybody who works with her is delicious and amazing and incredible.
When did Howie become amazing?
And delicious.
And my disaster's in the press, therefore the title spinning out of control.
It's going to be in the E! Network right after the Oscars. The Oscars go till midnight.
Yeah.
Right after the Oscars. She's pretending like it's a real network and they have the Oscars. E! Doesn't have the Oscars. They stick Joan Rivers with a microphone out on the carpet.
And they throw her out.
Yeah. Joan's not even allowed in. You're going to be on right after the Howard Stern show. That gets, is the only thing that gets ratings. Why don't you mention that?
What about that?
The delicious Howie Mandel, who she let his balls hang out to dry during the Halle Berry incident.
Right.
Anyway, Neil, you're on the air.
Oh, yeah, hi, Howard. What I don't understand is, how come you're so obsessed about Kathy Lee? I mean, I've been listening to
because I'm in love with her, all right?
Yeah, but I mean, she's just like some woman who wants to go about whatever stupid thing she does all day. I'm like, oh, you know, what's the big deal?
I'm obsessed.
Yeah, you can't determine what
I'm sorry.
Like.
I can't help it. You can't explain an obsession. Why did Skippy beat up David Spade?
Nobody knows.
I have another question.
By the way, we would have had David Spade on the phone today, but Spade left me a message last night that was really bizarre.
Just reading the paper about how Cody Gifford, Kathy Lee's son, has been given a summer internship over at the Today Show where she now works. And the kid is a movie reviewer, guest movie reviewer for the Today Show.
That's his internship?
Yes. They say in the paper, while most children, even if celebrities, get an internship, they're not necessarily on the air.
Right.
But I watched the kid. Good-looking kid.
Is he?
A handsome kid. He looks almost, here's the deal. Kathy Lee, you know, I always criticize her, but look, she loves her kid. She wants him on TV, but you're never doing your kid a favor doing that because They made him the movie reviewer. He has no credentials to be a movie reviewer, and it's cute to see Kathy Lee's kid doing something, and yet the whole segment, I watched the Today Show, the whole segment looks out of place. And
really?
Yeah, and the kid's, you know, he's...
Is it her version of the Today Show?
Yes.
Okay.
It's her hour.
Okay.
And, you know, it's out of place, but it'd be one thing if she put her arm around him and said, this is my son, and hey, we went to the movies and we had some fun, and you want to tell people what you thought of the new Tom Cruise movie. But instead, he comes on like the movie reviewer, and he has no real solid sort of movie review. You know, when you hear a movie review, you really want to hear a journalist's approach to criticism, like a Simon Cowell of American Idol, so to speak. You want to see it. And the kid, you know, the kid comes off kind of stiff, and that's it. It's an internship. And he says he wants to be a movie director. But, you know, you put your kid in that thing, and all of a sudden, it's it reeks of nepotism. People get resentful. The kid looks like a, he's so good looking, I don't know if he had to develop a real personality. That's my guess. Listen, I grew up where I had to develop a personality even to be noticed. I'm not a handsome man. So, you know, this kid's good looking. He's Kathy Lee's kid. He's Frank Gifford's kid. And he hasn't really had to develop much of a personality. He's
so
a sweet kid.
There's nobody tapping him and saying, you know, you're such a great personality.
Yeah.
We need to get you on camera.
No, he needs my father going, you know, you're a fucking moron. you're dopey. You're an idiot. He needs to have a little...
Adversity?
Adversity, yeah.
He needs a speed bump.
Give him some character.
Yeah.
In life.
He does. He's just he's very, very handsome. Like a John Stamos kind of type.
Ooh.
You know, he's a handsome kid. And he...
Now he's on TV.
Now he's on TV. Life can't get any easier than that. Wow, now I'm on TV.
How'd that happen?
Kid's probably getting a ton of pussy. I mean...
How old is he?
I'd love to interview him. I'd love to find out how old he was when he started to get fucking laid in a serious way.
How old is he now?
I don't know, but he's got to get tons of pussy. He looks like every kid wants a look, and, you know, he's got the rich parents. And the... How old is he, 20?
Yeah.
I guarantee you he started getting laid
20?
At 15.
I think he got married, started getting laid at 12.
Yeah. And the mom put him on TV. And, you know, he kind of comes off like one of the... You ever go to Disneyland and they got those robots that, you know...
The animatronics.
Whatever you want to call that.
When they do the presidents and all that.
Yeah. Hey, sweet kid. I got nothing against them, you know. And I really don't have anything against Kathy Lee. It's just that she makes a lot of wrong moves. She doesn't understand what she's doing necessarily. You know?
Yeah, in Kathy Lee's world, all of this is fine. It's
yeah.
Just what should happen.
Yeah, you know, let the kid go out and do his thing. You don't have to... This is... What is this? Here, I'll just...
You know, I also don't think anybody who really wants to direct wants to be a critic.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, here he reviews Story 3, which every reviewer loves, and Jonah Hex, which got a lot of bad reviews. I just wonder, when it comes to a bad review, can he really give the bad review? Or is he trying to make everything positive like his mother,
yeah,
who's a
Christian?
Yeah,
because he's trying to open doors for himself. Forget
Christian.
Exactly.
And it is time now for a weekend movie preview with Cody Gifford. And if you're going to go see a movie with Dad for Father's Day, there are two big films in the theaters this weekend. Our resident film student Cody Gifford is here to tell us all about them. Hello, Cody.
How we doing?
Nice. Good.
Okay, so you have two. One you loved. One was a home run. What was the home run movie?
Toy Story 3 is a winner.
Yeah?
It's definitely a winner.
Uh-huh.
I don't think Pixar can do wrong.
Yeah.
Their digital animation is kind of unrivaled right now, and it has been for the past, you know, 15 years, since 1995. I loved it. I think
ultimately, who cares what he thought of
it? Yeah, for the past 15 years when I was 3.
Yeah.
I'm sitting next to this little girl in the theater, a 7-year-old little girl, and she's laughing her head off the whole time. And I'm sitting there, like, wrestling with themes of, like, leaving home and feeling like you don't matter. And I'm, you know, like, all scholarly about it. And she's cracking up the whole time. And at the end, I'm really, you know, I hate to say about these little toys, but I'm moved. I'm touched. You know, I'm a 20-year-old guy, and I'm sitting there, like, thank God I had 3D glasses on. You know? I don't see any... Yeah, but, I mean, that's what movies are about.
Does it reach the levels of the...
Yeah, she's like, oh, we haven't talked before.
Yeah. So I don't know what
I didn't talk to you at breakfast about what you were going to say.
Let me see.
First and second, dude, because we don't like another sequel unless it can either reach or go beyond the originals.
I remember seeing the first and second when I was a little kid, obviously. And there's a...
She's so proud. It's her son. You know, I get it, but...
Chest all puffed out.
Yeah. My son is so handsome, and he's...
And she's like, our student, blah, blah, blah. My son.
Yeah. Well, they probably worked that out ahead of time. You know, like, God bless. What are you going to do?
But it would be so much more genuine if she said, you know, like, I got my kid this internship, and I'm putting him on TV, so...
And fuck all of you if you don't like it. Right. Especially Howard Stern.
You know, get your son on TV. Get yourself on TV and get your son on TV if you don't like it.
Right. It's probably no different than the Osbournes putting their kids on TV, I guess, in some way.
Well, they didn't put them on as authorities in anything.
Right, that's true. And you got me there.
It was like, we're a family, we're a mess, watch us.
Yeah. I want to see when he gets to the bad part of the review. Can he give something a bad review?
Yeah, well, he picked on Jonah Hex where, you know, it won't
magic
matter.
Every Pixar movie. This one, you experience that magic again as an adult for me, and I think it's probably even better than the second one, in my opinion.
You're not an adult yet, all right? You're still under my roof.
No, he's an adult. Legally, I'm an adult. We're not going to go into that right
and
now.
And there's one that you hate it.
Come on, I don't...
Hate's a strong word.
You're going to get me in trouble with people out on the West Coast.
No, I saw this one with you, and I this one's called Jonah Hex.
They don't talk. Fortunately, he's learning from how to broadcast from his mom, so everyone talks all over each other. But
you said exactly what is the problem. Right away, saying, don't say I hated it.
Right.
Because I don't want to get into trouble with people on the West Coast.
Right. He doesn't want to get in trouble with people on the West Coast. He's still living in his mom's house. Who's he going to be in trouble with?
Tell us about it.
Jonah Hex is about a Confederate soldier who disobeys his commanding officer's orders, and his family is murdered in front of him.
Ooh.
And he's emotionally scarred, physically scarred, as you can see.
As you can see. And that's Josh Brolin, right?
Mm-hmm. And it's just violence. There is a lot of violence. Yeah. The PG-13 rating, it definitely pushes the limit on that one.
I think it should be R, Cody. There's so much gratuitous violence in this. What do you think?
I think there is that. But along with that, the motivation's not really there for some of the characters. There's some issues with the script that I had.
Yeah.
Megan Fox is in it, though.
So. Yeah, tell us about Megan Fox.
The whole game.
It does. Yeah. I mean, for marketing, definitely. But, you know, she's beautiful.
Yeah.
She's one of the sexiest women on the planet.
Really?
In my opinion. Yeah, she's pretty cute. She's cute. But every movie she's been in so far, she's been, you know, kind of objectified. And this one, from the first frame, her, like, pulling up a stocking or whatever, it's kind of...
It's every kid's fantasy, isn't it?
I had,
Cody.
Yeah.
We love you. I want to hear about my kid's fantasy.
We'll be right back next week.
He beat off. Now you know. Hey, hey, hey.
Next, well, she can't shut up long enough for you to even hear what he has to say.
No. He's actually more interesting than her.
She took over the whole review, though.
Yeah, well, she's nervous.
You know what? It's very funny. I don't think it's nervous. It's that she can't stop talking. She can't stop and even let him have any of the attention.
Yeah. Well, then they did
so
a segment.
She starts yelling out what he thought of the movie.
Then the daughter, Cassidy Gifford, came out and gave financial advice. She did a whole segment on that. It's great. Well, I don't know if you're doing your kid any favor doing that.
You know what? They should start a new TV show, Good Morning with the Giffords.
Right.
And they could do every segment. You know, Cody could be the reviewer, Cassidy could be the fashion consultant, and Mom and Dad are the hosts.
I might have to tune in for that. Well, I was kind of fascinated to see what young Cody grew up to be like.
I would certainly love to see him.
Yeah. It didn't seem like a bad kid or anything. It just seemed like things went really well for him. A, he's fucking handsome. B, he's got rich parents. C, he wants to be a movie director, so they made him the movie intern reviewer on the Today Show.
Right.
I mean, I don't know. Listen, as a kid who grew up feeling like there was no future for me, and that, like when I would see stuff like that on TV, it would make me berserk.
Well, even listening to him, he's assured he's going to be a director.
Yeah.
You know, there's no...
There's no doubt.
You know, there's no anxiety. There's no feeling like this might not work out. Everything's going to work out.
Right. Well, everything does work out for him.
I mean, it's a wonderful thing, I suppose, to feel that way.
He's 20, still living with his mom, huh? No college for this kid?
Well, maybe. I'm sure he goes to college.
At home?
I think he went already, Howard.
Well, he's 20. Has he graduated?
I guess that's around the age.
About 21 years later.
I'm almost sure he went to USC, which is where his dad went.
He went to USC? And so when he goes to USC, does... you mean he goes and lives in the dorm, and then he comes home and he lives with the parents?
I think so, yeah.
All right.
Yeah, like a college student.
I think he's there on a partial football scholarship.
Must be fun for living over there, because I know I couldn't wait to get the fuck out of my parents' house. Like, I graduated college and I went, I got to get the hell out of here. I got to get a job. I came home after college, now that I recall.
Yes. Where else were you going to go?
And my parents, if I had just anything lined up, I would have gone anywhere else. Whenever I came home, I felt like a worm and a maggot. And so, you know, then I began my job search. It was nothing better than coming home to my dad and saying, what are you doing?
How did it go?
How did it? Well, he didn't even ask me how it went.
No?
That's the end, right. And then he knew how it went. He knew exactly how it went. My dad was good. You know, sometimes he would take my audition tapes for radio and give them to the guys that he knew from radio and give them to program directors and general managers in Manhattan. But they weren't looking for me. I was a schlub. But my dad tried to help out, so I can't fault Kathy Lee. But then I'd have to tell my dad how I distributed my resumes. And the fact was that I was sitting in a coffee shop for, like, the entire day. And I would just sit there and drink coffee and hope that the day would pass quickly. Then I'd buy a lottery ticket with the money that my parents had given me.
Oh, I'm just looking at Cassidy. Cassidy's a beauty.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Good. She might probably marry some retard. Anyway, you know, after all of Kathy Lee's hard work on that kid, she'll marry some douche. You know, but anyway, I just remember it being a dismal time, and it seems like it's a lot easier at the Gifford house.
Well, of course, the streets have been paved for him over smoothly, so there are no bumps.
Hey, good for him. Let me tell you, that all that agitating ain't good. I remember telling my dad, he goes, I came home and told him I got him a job at Benton Bowles Advertising Agency. What is that? What kind of job? I said, well, it's marketing. You know, like, okay. And then I had to go home and tell them I quit because it sucked. Actually, I sucked. But then when I got that job at WRNW for $96 a week, I just went out and bought a palace to live in. Once I had the $96 a week, it was great. Well, my parents really helped me out, too, because they got me a car and they even gave me a credit card for gas. I don't think I could have swung it otherwise. I don't think I could have afforded that job.
You wouldn't have been on your own.
No. Then I was able to take my 96 a week and give it to the that monastery I lived in. And they gave me a place to live where you couldn't watch TV or look at or listen to a radio or read
talk,
a book.
Right?
Talk or read a book. You had a cot. It was like similar to a prison cot. I think prison cots are nicer. And then you laid there until the next day and you went to work. Things were really looking up. If my mom could have got me an internship on the Today Show, it probably would have been detrimental at that point because I would have really sucked.
Yeah.
And I don't need people seeing that and goofing on me. Whatever.
A couple of phone calls. Then I want to talk about Kathy Lee because I just finished watching the tape.
Oh, I wish I had seen the tirade.
Wait a second. Here, wait. I got to play some of this.
You got to on TV?
Here's the deal. So Michael Kennedy goes into a tree.
Playing football on skis.
Like the guy's 39 years old, he's playing football on skis.
What a way to go.
Yeah, so it's crazy. The guy, what's going on here? The guy.
Yeah, Fred's losing it.
Fred's over there. Fred just hit a tree.
Yeah.
Takes him a while to get warmed up. So anyway, the guy goes head first into a tree. What was your first reaction? You went, oh. The baby rapist went into a...
Well, I said, you know, if he hadn't fought so hard to beat that rap, he'd have been safe in jail.
Yeah, right. He should have been in jail.
Horrible payback.
Right. The place he should have been was in jail.
That's right.
You know? Who messed with my microphone while I was gone?
Anybody could.
I want this louder. Hello?
You got it all
test,
the way up?
Test. Testing, 1, 2.
Testing. Green,
we will now test this for
probably. We will now test... I'll get that worked out
thank
after the
you.
Show. So anyway, where was I?
That Michael. Somebody,
okay. All right. So like you said, Michael Kennedy should have been in jail for being with a 14-year-old.
Right.
Yeah.
That's called rape.
Yeah.
All right.
She looks 16.
If somebody raped my 14-year-old, I'd shoot him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's what I would do to them. I'd kill them.
Mm-hmm.
So he should have been in jail.
That's Kathy right, Lee wouldn't be dead now.
Kathy Lee goes into this whole rap how she was. Now, first of all, who even knew Kathy Lee had a connection to the Kennedys?
Yeah, it was kind of a vague notion
right.
that we had.
Yeah. This was the biggest scumbag Kennedy on the planet.
Well, so I don't know. They have some big comeback candidates.
That's a talk.
So she, yeah, right, sure. So, all right, so whatever. He's in the top five. So all of a sudden, like, you're going, okay, hey, you know, it's sad, you know, I guess somebody died and everything. Ethel Kennedy's had a lot of grief and all this kind of crap. But you know what? Her son had sex with the 14-year-old babysitter.
Right.
He admitted to it.
What's wrong with that?
Yeah, but he had the best deal of all of them.
What?
He had the best deal of all of them.
What do you mean?
Yeah, he got the youngest one.
All right, listen.
Have
I, you know what? Why don't you guys?
Breaking shot ball.
Yeah, you know. Just
go warm up the car.
Just be quiet while I.
Hey, that's funny.
When Scott's in here, you can open your mouth.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to hear that. Yeah. It's like the idiot Tina getting
a limo driver.
She had the best one.
Yeah, yeah. We gotta stop and figure out what they're talking about.
Yeah, I know.
Learn how to use it to defroster on the car.
Right. Right.
Shut up! Hey, Chuggy! Shut!
Okay. So, okay, she gets on the air. She talks about how she's at the funeral. And they, you know, their Catholic faith and everyone, they're good Christians.
It's very real to them.
And then she starts to go into a tirade about the press and how the press should mind their own business because she goes, you know, the press, he allegedly had sex with his babysitter. Allegedly, it's something he admitted to. Allegedly. And she's saying, you know, his children should know he was a good man.
Ugh. Oh, and she can justify anything.
And the press should mind their own business in the case of rape. The press should mind its own business.
That was her precious Cassidy.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
I can't wait. It would be a completely different story.
I hope a man, when Cassidy turns 14, has sex with Cassidy.
Well, she won't be babysitting anywhere.
Yeah, I hope that happens. Oh, And I hope it's Cody.
It'll probably be the gardener.
I hope it's Frank.
I hope Al Rosenberg hires Cody to work around his house, and Al Rosenberg rapes Cody. How's that?
And then I'll ski into a tree.
Right.
Yeah.
I think Frank should rape him.
probably already has.
No, he hasn't.
How do you know?
No, he hasn't.
Allegedly.
You know, let me turn it off.
Just conjecture.
No. No, you're an idiot. He has one thing about Frank, he has consensual sex. He really does.
We got that on the tape.
He
ain't raping nobody. Anyway, listen, he's too old to rape somebody. Okay, listen. So she's on there defending Michael Kennedy.
Yeah. Oh, none of us have perfect lives.
Yeah. Can you? Well, that's, of course, a reference. Of course, she does have a perfect life.
Oh, yeah.
And then she said, you know, what a good Kennedy he was because he had that stupid, you know, the family set up that gas company or something?
Yeah.
To give him something to do because he was so damn idle?
Excuse me.
Well, they're all idle.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
They all need pet projects.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You have to see this. She is a nincompoop.
And everybody carries on like, oh, that was such a wonderful thing. He set up a company to give heating oil to the poor and cut rates.
Regis,
well, what else is he going
to
do?
Regis is sitting there watching this like he wants to strangle her.
Yeah, Regis
he hates
sleeping.
Her. He hates her.
Yeah, because he just wanted to get past it.
Yeah. Oh, it was unbelievable.
But no, she had to go on her little
they were playing clips
monologue.
They were playing clips of it all over the news. It was us all over the news. Where is it?
And you can tell there's such a strain between the two of them.
Oh.
I watched it the next day.
Please.
And they had to address the headlines in the newspaper.
Yeah.
And she has this phony laugh that she puts on. She finds nothing funny.
Right. Right.
And
she's humorless.
Her laugh is ha ha ha.
Yeah, right.
You know.
Yeah. She's a nut.
Squeal at the end. But that's not a real laugh. This is a miserable woman.
And Sonny Bono wanted to be a Kennedy. Because he went into politics, he tried to do everything like the Kennedys,
right.
And so he had to go crash into a tree. That's all that he did.
He did.
We had Sonny,
copycat.
We had Sonny Bono on this show.
We did?
On the phone, yeah. In fact, I pulled it. So, and not
you
only
know
did
what, I completely forgot?
He was promoting a cookie business.
Yeah.
And then Stuttering John got a hold of him,
oh,
too.
That's right.
I think he once called into us.
Wow.
I think. I have that in my memory. I know Stuttering John got him.
Yeah.
Because I have that.
A cookie business. Like what didn't he do?
I have new sunglasses.
Ski thing.
What didn't he do? He didn't ski.
Yeah.
Or thing.
Hold on. I got this right here. I got such dark sunglasses on, I can't see.
Hey, anything. What are you doing?
I brought my wrong sunglasses on. I can't see a thing.
You're going to miss Scott's push-up.
I know. I know. I won't be able to see anything.
Stuttering John here with Sonny Bono.
How are you? Good. I'm great. How are you?
Great, great. Good. So you're selling cookies?
Among other things, yeah.
How long have you been in this business?
About 3 days. We've actually been working on it for almost a year.
I don't even think that lasted more than a week.
No, I don't remember the cookie business.
The Sonny Bono cookie business.
year and a half, but this is our third day of just announcing the line. It's interesting. I mean, it certainly is different. I've been in the food business for a long time with my restaurant.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, about eight or 9 years now.
Okay, can I ask you, who's a better mayor, you or Marion Barry?
Me or Marion Barry? Well, I don't know if I could compare myself with Marion Barry. I think I'm a very good mayor in my town. I think you add up how good a mayor is after he leaves office and see how his scorecard is. But I think mine will be pretty good after the end of four.
Okay, let me ask you, are you taller than Gary Coleman?
Yes, about an inch.
As a mayor, if your city had tourists being stabbed and shot, could you relax courtside at the U.S. Open?
No.
So you don't approve of Dinkins then?
Well, I guess he really likes tennis a lot.
Will you ever get to see Cher's tattoo?
I've seen it. I haven't seen the new one. I've seen the old one. I don't think I'll ever get to see the new one, unless it's on television.
Do you think that Richie Zambora will ever be mayor of Palm Springs?
Do I think what?
That Richie Zambora will ever be mayor of Palm Springs?
Zambora.
No. Maybe Anaheim.
Do you still smoke pot?
No, I never did.
No?
Yeah.
No.
What's the wildest thing that ever happened?
It's all right.
I guess they were trying to throw him out, but
yeah,
Sonny was cool.
Yeah, people saying it's a Howard Stern person.
Yeah, but you know what? Sonny's doing just fine.
Yeah, Howard. I mean, he's hanging.
He's hanging. He hung 10 right into his tree.
Yeah, you know what? I was talking to somebody this morning about
that. Such an embarrassing way to die.
I know that Michael Kennedy was playing football, which is ridiculous.
Well, you know what it is? Somebody. Oh, you know who said this to me? Fran Shea.
What?
Of the E! Network. And she's right. Now, first you're going to go, what the hell is this? The reason those two guys died,
uh-huh.
It's a guy thing. It's the reckless pursuit of youth. Now, think about that. Guys?
Well, okay.
That age are always trying to prove that they're fit and young and able to do everything.
But wait a minute.
Push-ups.
Right.
I think that Sonny was just skiing downhill.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
when you see a tree coming, you sit down.
Hey, Tony Danza, he went right head first into the tree.
What is it?
You know what it
people?
Is? They go real fast. And they. You know what? It wasn't that, you know, most ski slopes are free of trees. Like when you go down, they have a path that you
right,
can follow.
Right.
These guys are advanced skiers.
No, so he was on an intermediate course.
He was?
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, here's what I heard on the radio this morning. Yeah. First of all, they say that the number one deaths in ski accident are males who are expert skiers.
Right.
Those are the number one guys who will die.
Right.
They think that, you know,
they think they're better than they are.
And they were saying that Sonny had skied this course a lot of times.
Right.
And that it looked like he was trying to go over to another...
Switch courses.
He got bored.
But he knew the course so well that he had to go through this tree-lined area. That's what they suspect.
Yeah. He went through, because I know
he
there were a lot of trees.
He decided to go through the trees.
Yeah, there were a lot of trees.
But the point is, like, you don't have to hit the tree.
No, you could avoid the tree,
I'm
but...
sure he didn't want to.
No, you could fall down.
Yeah, well, he didn't care. He was, you know what? He probably thought he cleared the tree. Or there were so many trees in that area, he probably cleared three.
He cleared one and went into another.
Right, exactly.
Oh.
The guy's 60-something years old. He's an old man.
Why is he even skiing?
Yeah.
And I understand that in the case of Michael Kennedy, they had called Ethel, like, the day before.
Right.
To try to get her to stop them from playing this football game.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they knew it was dangerous and they wanted to, and people are still trying to ski.
Right.
When these whack balls
not playing
are
football.
Skiing back and forth and throwing a ball
right.
on the slope.
Well, not even a ball. It's whatever they throw. It's a water bottle filled with ice water.
So stupid.
Was it like a tradition or something?
Yeah, a tradition.
30 years.
Like, yeah, you know, but it's so dangerous that they wanted him to stop and they called mommy on the boys.
I have this friend who, you ever knew, like, there's a guy making up a sport. It's a sport that he's good at because he's good on skis, so he's going to fill up a water bottle and run around. That's like I got this guy I know.
Uh-huh.
He loved soccer, but he wasn't good enough at soccer, so he made up a thing where you kick a sock. It's called Saki. So he plays that. So, you know, it's kind of like a weird thing, but he's the only one who's good at it.
What a fag.
Yeah. Not a fag.
Oh,
all right.
Well, I mean,
all right.
Stick.
All right. And a fag.
No, you don't
know. He just invented his own sport.
I can't play
the homo.
You're a homo.
You're a homo.
Yeah.
That's all.
I can't play the real game.
Yeah. That's not even a voice you're doing. Okay, so. Okay.
What am I doing?
So.
Al's time to leave.
Al, what are you doing here?
Yeah, really.
I'll go warm up the car.
Good idea. Anyway, the Kathy Lee tantrum, defending now the Kennedys, because she wants to be a Kennedy.
Oh, and the other thing she said was that Frank said.
Yeah.
That Michael was the best amateur skier that he had ever seen.
You know what's amazing? Here's the guy. Frank could be furious with this effing guy.
Right.
This guy.
So wants to be a Kennedy.
It's not so bad that the guy dumped his daughter. He dumped for a 14-year-old babysitter.
And according to reports, the woman walked in and found them in bed with the girl.
Yeah. Instead, they're all sitting there talking about their Catholic faith and what good people they are. And what a great guy he was. The guy should have been in prison for what he did. And the only reason he wasn't in prison is because he paid off the family or something. I don't know what happened. Or the family refuses to press charges.
They wouldn't press charges.
Oh, I would press charges, man. Big time. Did he make a payment to the family? No one knows.
No one knows. I mean,
no one knows.
You know.
I don't know what went on.
Under the table, behind the scenes.
Yeah.
All we know is that they decided they didn't want to talk about it anymore.
And Kathy Lee's like, it was a beautiful story. And then she goes, Kevin.
Costner.
No, she didn't say Costner.
Oh.
She goes, Kevin wanted us to use Kevin.
Just Kevin.
Kevin.
He doesn't even identify who Kevin is.
We have to know who that is. We're offered his private jet for us to fly down. Like, shut up. Now she is, and she's talking about cradling one of the Kennedy children. In her arms, Rory, who is 10 years old.
Yeah, that's, I guess, the son of Michael and Victoria.
And she realized that Ethel had to cradle their youngest son, who was 10 years old, when Bobby Kennedy was killed. And here was Kathy Lee now cradling Rory.
Who's going to cradle the babysitter?
Yeah.
Yeah, who's taking care
right.
of her?
Hey, now.
Hey, now.
Yeah.
Kneeled in a bald cap with a Scott hookup. It's unbelievable.
Oh, is that a cap?
Yeah.
Kathy Lee's like a drama queen.
Kathy Lee so queen. Badly wants to be royalty.
Connected to them.
I love that Frank cheated on her.
Anything that they do should be forgiven.
Yeah.
Other people, regular people, should go to jail and be fried.
Yeah, right.
But the Kennedys...
Oh, she's insane.
...should be honored.
You're evil, but...
And Michael Kennedy should have been in jail.
Oh, what?
And Kathy Lee should be in jail.
Wasn't criminal.
Yeah. Well, that's what she said.
Wrong.
About Uncle Ted.
She said, this is what she said. She said, you know, this woman's insane. If it was anybody else, she'd be all over it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Forget what the law says.
She goes, I want his children to know. And what he did might have been, you know, look funny, but it was not criminal because he took 3 lie detector tests and he didn't have sex with her till she was 16, which is the legal age.
Oh, wow, yeah.
So that's good.
Right.
That's really good.
Like he was priming her from the age of 14 to 16.
Yeah.
Priming everything was fine.
And how old
that.
Was he?
He was 39. He was a good man because he got free gasoline or something to some poor people, which the family set up.
Yeah, and...
To make them look like good people.
Didn't, cause him any sweat.
Right.
It was nice publicity for him.
Yeah, please.
While he humped the babysitter.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's Kathy Lee, like, instead of just shutting her mouth or going, you know what, this guy humped a babysitter.
Yeah, let's just be quiet. Put him in the ground and be quiet.
Yeah, let's keep this quiet. Do the guy a favor.
No, we're marching along like this is Robert Kennedy we're burying.
Out of all the people in the world she could defend, she's defending Michael Kennedy. When she has a daughter. Oh. Unbelievable.
And then she says, and I looked at Ethel's face.
Yeah, and I said, I hope my face doesn't wrinkle like that.
You know what? The other thing that I thought was rather weird was that she's talking about how Ethel Kennedy is cracking jokes at the funeral.
Yeah, well, that's great.
You know, it's like these people are, you know, they have 50 million kids. That's why you lose one or two.
Well, if your son grew up to be a babysitter rapist, I'd be glad he was gone. I'd be laughing too. I'm cracking jokes. Hey, the rapist is gone. No, but Kathy Lee's on there going, he's a great guy. He didn't have sex with her until she was 16. That's legal age. I want his kids to know he didn't have sex with a babysitter.
Well, just realize that Kathy Lee thinks it's open season on your 16-year-old.
Well, good. I can't wait till her daughter hits 14. I'm going to start priming that pump.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Baby.
He's 2 years from ready.
Yeah. You know, there was videotape of the actual Michael Kennedy running into the tree.
Of course, because everything they do has to be documented.
Well, yeah. Really? Yeah. Of course, there was no videotape with him with the babysitter.
No.
Wayne.
The camera camera was off then.
But this is Kathy Lee. This is a sick, sick woman. This is her morality.
This is nobody to defend.
No. Just shut your mouth. You went to the funeral because Frank's kids and... I mean, it's a mess. The guy was a walking mess. Hey, I know lots of guys cheat. I know lots of guys have affairs and stuff. But not with a 14-year-old.
Not with a child.
Right. Wayne, you're on the air.
How you doing? How long morning, Robin? Rich?
By the way, Wayne is with a 14-year-old right now.
He has another point of view.
Yeah. Wayne, do you have a 14-year-old with you?
Yes, I recommend it. I was wondering, have you heard any stories on who threw the pass that killed Michael Kennedy?
I think it was Ethel, wasn't it?
Dan Marino.
Oh, yeah. He was up there just to play that
put it in the tree!
That wacky game.
You button hook at the tree.
Yeah, right. No, we don't know who threw the actual pass.
They have it.
But evidently, he was the family champion at this game.
Right.
He's the best.
Yeah.
You think they're going to cancel it now?
Yeah, I think that game's over.
Yeah, everybody's, you know, looking for reasons to praise him. What he really did well was play football on skis.
The priest should have gotten up and said, look, there's two things this guy did well. Sex with the babysitter.
But that's easy.
And he skied. And everyone would have started throwing stuff. It would have been great. And Kathy Lee. Kathy's on, you know, it was one of the most beautiful services. It shows the faith the Kennedys have. And I was just like, you know, stop all your phoniness.
Their faith was very real to them.
Do you see why I always make fun of Kathy Lee? Now it's sort of in fashion to make fun of Kathy Lee. But do you see why she drove me nuts? She's she's horrible.
I've never seen anybody like her. I hope they broke the mold when they made her.
Yeah, they did. They did.
She's an original.
They did.
And we don't need any more.
Hey, by the way.
Sometimes I watch these shows like the Today Show and stuff. They'll have somebody on with gadgets and things. And the guy gets like 3 seconds to explain. Like even anything on these shows is done in 3 seconds.
Right. And he'll have like 12 items on a table because they bring a lot of stuff. And he might get to race through 4 of them.
I was watching like Hoda and Kathy Lee. And Hoda and Kathy Lee couldn't care less what the person. They have to get their airtime and they fight each other for airtime.
Yeah.
So they're talking over each other. The other guy's trying to show gadgets. Oh, that's a good gift. Oh, Cody, you love that. And the Hoda's like, and then the guy's like, this is an iPhone. And it's just blah, 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 blah. And you fucking don't know one goddamn thing. I was watching Lisa G. She was on some newscast, Channel 11.
Oh, you're doing the baking segment. I
wanted to take the people on this show and strangle them. Lisa G's on there. They have her to bake something. Okay, if you're going to watch, let's see her bake.
Yeah, get it done.
Well, Lisa goes on there. Am I right? And she says, well, today we're going to bake, I don't know, fucking cupcakes.
Brownies,
all right? She starts to explain. Blah, 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 blah. The two hosts start in.
They want to know about you.
Yeah, they're talking about Howard. They're talking about this and that. It was like amateur hour. And you never found out how to cook the brownies.
I've seen these segments on like these Sunday morning shows. They'll always have like the green grocer or somebody's supposed to be in there telling you how to prepare something.
Right.
And the next thing you know, the guy's slinging ingredients all over the place.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't have any time.
And they want to be funny.
Right.
And it's like, well, what's the point?
And then it's like, well, take it out of the oven. He cooked it 2 hours ago. Let us taste it and let's get on with it.
That Hoda and Kathy Lee are the funniest. I watch them sometimes.
I have seen that show occasionally.
It's absolutely schizophrenic. Kathy Lee has got to fucking talk. She's afraid of being forgotten.
She can't help herself.
She will not just be quiet. You know.
And it's all related to her.
What's this?
Well,
a cook telling Kathy Lee to be quiet on today on
Let me hear that.
Whoever this is a genius. If this is for real, let me hear this. Where'd you find this, guys? A cook telling Kathy Lee to shut the fuck up? I love it. Where'd you find this, JD?
It's a clip from a while ago.
Okay.
It's on the internet.
A couple of weeks?
No, like a long time ago.
Okay. But because this is, who's the cook, do you know?
I think it says Sam the Cooking Guy, whatever that is.
Sam the Cooking Guy should get in a medal.
We got to find him.
And Lisa, when you're on that show, you should do that too.
Tell him to shut the fuck up.
You
get the cooking done.
You have me here to cook. Let me do it.
It does. It smells awfully good, too.
Okay, so we got this done,
so
right?
We did
all pretty,
pasta.
Really good, nice,
okay,
right?
Sam.
Now we
right,
whip her
go.
On back down
okay,
here. Come
on.
Over here. Come
all
here.
All right, let's go. What are we making?
Kathy's
tuna?
Giving me the okay, Sam. So
tuna.
We're making a
why
tuna.
Why all of it in
we're
there?
Making a tuna.
Tuna's the second thing we have in our house.
Can I talk? I watch the show every day. Everybody has issues with a lot of chatter back here. Pay attention 1 minute.
Nice.
Ooh, yeah,
I hope
working.
You enjoy your he probably has never
I hope
done
you enjoyed
a show
your
again.
Last time at the Today Show.
Yeah,
I'm really kidding.
Yeah.
You. And I've already complimented you on how pretty you are.
I was lying about your eyebrows. I think they're shabby.
Right. Okay. Onion. I don't even know what I got. Cucumber, tomato, Kalamata olives. We're basically making like a standard Greek salad, right?
Right.
We take some feta cheese. I love to buy the block feta cheese. I can hear the crew back there going, this guy, it's his last day here for sure.
Let me tell you something.
By the way,
Kathy Lee is all insulted. If that fucking Kathy Lee would listen to the tape of what they were doing to this guy, the guy lost it. Now, I you know what? I don't know the show that well. I hope this guy has been back since. I guess he hasn't. But I'm going to tell you something. She's rude as can be, this Kathy Lee. She's such a hog on the camera. She's so unchristian-like, she's got to fucking hug the goddamn camera. She's on for a whole hour. It's not enough for her. She wants to gobble up the world, that hungry cunt. Let me tell you something. This Kathy Lee, this guy set her so straight, and you heard they don't
oh
talk to us
God.
Like that.
Oh, my God, yeah, they were silent. They
this
didn't know what
poor
to do.
Bastard is trying to get out one word. And he can't get it out. The guy is he's being suffocated by these yentas. God bless Sam. What's his name?
Sam the cooking
Sam
guy.
Sam the cooking guy.
I should have had him on the show. He's probably unemployed now because that Kathy Lee probably did him in. You
he
have no
lives on the street.
Idea how he spoke to me. The great Kathy Lee. Fuck you. Weren't you the singer on Name That Tune, you bitch? Give the guy a chance. He's got 2 seconds on the show. You've had an hour. Give him 2 minutes to give the recipe.
You're on every day.
Yeah, every day. You're not going anywhere. Don't worry. We're not going to forget you're there. Oh, she's so hungry. Her hunger irritates me. Her hunger irritates me.
And I couldn't understand what the guy was up to.
No. Listen to what... I'm going to play that again because this is a perfect example. And I wish I had the interview with Lisa G., because you'd hear the same crap going on. Don't have a guest on if you don't want him to talk.
It does. It smells awfully good, too.
Okay, so we got this done,
so
right?
We did
all pretty,
pasta.
Really good, nice,
okay,
right?
Sam.
Now,
all
we
right,
whip her
go.
On back down
okay,
here. Come on here. Come
all
here.
All right, let's go. What are we making, Kathy's tuna?
Giving me the...
By the way, listen to what's going on in the background. They're not adding a thing to it.
Okay, well, let's go.
Okay, what... I mean, who can talk? I would have a nervous breakdown. I never liked Kathy Lee. I can't warm up to this broad. I'm trying to mend fences, you know, but I can't with this one. She's selfish. She's a cackling hen. I've had it with her. I'm serious, Robin.
How did she get back on TV?
Who let her back on?
It's that NBC.
Oh, that NBC.
It does. It smells awfully good, too.
Okay, so we got this done,
so
right?
We did
all
pasta.
Pretty, really good, nice,
okay,
right?
Sam.
Now, we
right,
whip her
go.
On back down
okay,
here. Come on here, come
all
here.
All right, let's go. What are we making?
Kathy's giving me the okay, Sam. So
tuna.
We're making a tuna.
Why don't you get all of it in
we're
there?
Making a tuna.
Tuna's the second
pizza.
Thing we have in our house.
Can I talk? I watch the show every day. Everybody has issues with a lot of chatter back here. Pay attention 1 minute. Ooh, that seems
I
to work.
I hope you enjoyed your...
All right, I hope you enjoyed your last time at the Today Show.
Yeah,
I'm really kidding. I love you. And I've already complimented you on how pretty you are.
I was lying about your eyebrows. I think they're shabby.
Right. Okay, onion. I don't even know what I got. Cucumber, tomato, Kalamata olives. We're basically making like a standard Greek salad, right?
Right.
We take some feta cheese. I love to buy the block feta cheese. I can hear the crew back there going, this guy, it's his last day here for sure.
They've been around a long time because they don't talk to us like that.
Yeah, they've been around.
Been
she
long
probably
time because they don't talk to us like that.
She probably, you know what? You know, in the real world, the guy stuck up for himself. He couldn't take it. He should have stuffed that food right in her mouth. I would have taken that.
Look,
what is he making there, Robin? What is he making?
It was
tuna?
A pasta, and then
pasta.
He went to a tuna.
I would have taken
yeah.
The. I would have taken the tuna, the noodles, and the feta cheese, and shoved it right in her fucking mouth. You know, in the real world, that's how things are settled. No one talks like, the only reason no one talks to you like that, because you're the fucking host of that dumb show. was back in Roosevelt, they teach you how to shut your mouth. Trust me. They get a hold of
but
you.
But did you notice?
And you know who I mean by
they
that.
They were gracious hosts after that.
Yep.
They listened to him.
Oh, yeah.
They commented when appropriate.
He should have stuck his fucking fork in her tongue. Yeah, whack.
And if the NBC had any sense, they'd have him on all the time.
Right.
Because there was something interesting to watch.
And you heard what he said, too, when he cracked. There's been a lot of talk back there about all this chatter.
Yeah.
And no one can get a word in. Yeah, the cook's name is Sam Zien, Z-I-E-N, Zen, and his website is thecookingguy.com, and he is my hero, and I love this guy, and I think he's a real man. And too bad he had to do the mea culpas back there afterwards. He shouldn't have.
But he still kept it light. He's an entertainer.
He's trying. That is the greatest single clip that should be played every day on this show. And he should be given an award. You know how they give out awards, Emmys? How about for a guy who has some balls? Unlike Jay Leno, who has no fucking balls. He bends over for NBC every 10 fucking seconds.
Well, that's probably why NBC won't have him back. He's a real man.
And try and hear what this guy's saying in the beginning of that clip. You can't hear a word. He must have been having a mental breakdown.
He couldn't even think about what he was doing.
And I'll bet you the night before, he's like, oh, my God, this is great. I'm going to be on the Today Show. It's going to be good for my career. People are going to see me. Maybe I'll get out of the Howard 100 news department. You know, something was going through his mind saying, this could be great. I'm sorry, I'm confused. Lisa's, the voice is in her head with Sam Zien.
Stop it.
But I got to tell you, before you go on TV, there's a lot of angst and a lot of thought that goes into it. This guy, Sam Zien, it's a big shot for him. And this Hoda and Kathy Lee, and I blame Kathy Lee.
You think Hoda was fine before Kathy got there?
I'm sure Hoda's fighting to get her own words in with this Kathy Lee. So the whole balance is off. Who knows? I don't know. I don't know. They both seem like they interrupt each other and everyone else.
Yeah.
And they think it's good television. And evidently NBC thinks it's good television. You know, whenever Beth does TV, she says to me, she did The View. She sat in one time, and I said, gee, you were quiet during that segment. She goes, they were all talking. I said, if everyone's talking, why would I talk? I said, that's evidently what they want in TV. They want people talking over
you
one another.
You have to keep talking in order to get the attention.
Right. Doesn't matter if you're saying anything. Just keep talking.
Because that Hoda was back there going, just, keep it going, keep it going, keep it going. She couldn't stop saying it.
Yeah, like Tourette's. They blurt out everything. Keep it going. Listen to the first 10 seconds of that clip. The guy couldn't take it. He broke. And then Kathy Lee, they have their jobs because they don't talk to us like that. Well, you're being rude, Kathy Lee. Can't anyone stand up to Kathy Lee? She's the devil.
Now you're getting like Dennis James.
She's the devil. Want to make monkey love to Harold Stern. Please. Are you kidding me?
You're right.
Having a heart attack. Where's my baby aspirin?
It does. It smells awfully good, too.
Okay, so we got this done,
so
right?
We did
all pretty.
Pasta.
Really good. Nice.
Okay,
right? Now,
right,
we whip her
go.
On back down
okay,
here. Come
on.
Over here. Come
all
here.
All right, let's go. What are we making?
Chad is giving me the okay, Sam. So
tuna.
We're making a tuna.
Well, I want you to get all of it in
we're
there.
Making a tuna.
Tuna's the second thing we have in our house.
Can I talk? I watch the show every day. Everybody has issues with a lot of chatter back here.
No wonder Frank has to fuck a stewardess.
It's a tuna Greek salad, I think.
Who could tell? The guy can't get a word out. It's his segment. Give him a chance. Okay, you want to help the segment? You want
to
say...
Have some interest in what he's doing.
Right. Stop. Okay, okay, okay. It's like having Scott Greenstein in the room with you.
It's like, can you cook with a lot of distractions going on?
No, yes, yes, no, yes, yes, yes.
Who do I respond to?
Send in Ozzy. Send Ozzy in. Get Ozzy out. Get Ozzy in. Ozzy in. Ozzy out.
And why invite a guy on if you're going to rush him through? You don't really have time for it.
Right. I mean, if we did... Here's what our show would sound like if everyone talked over each other like that. I prank! No one else!
You
boy, this is my world.
Here
I'm just letting you.
And if you
want to
make it on the way, I'm going to get your ass. Shut up! Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
That's what it would sound like.
That's what some of these shows do sound like.
Right.
Howard, 2 seconds, right on Gary preview page in the upper right-hand corner. JD's going to put up the etiquette expert.
Yeah, I got to hear that. Well, I got to hear what they did to this poor bastard. This is him trying to redeem himself to those yentas. He should have said, listen, they're rude. I can't get a word in.
I don't think he stuck to his guns.
I bet
think
not.
They dragged him back in there, and he was cowed.
Oh, yeah. Kathy Lee, you know, Kathy Lee's an angry woman. After all, isn't she scorned?
And don't you know, no one is ever supposed to interrupt or talk back to her.
Right. She's the star.
We're back with today's Summer Kitchen and a guy who, shall we say, stirred the pot, so to speak.
Yes, we often invite the most talented chefs in America to prepare some very delicious food on the show. Well, that's what we kind of thought, anyway. A couple of
weeks ago, Sam the Cooking Guy appeared with Kathy Lee and me, and it was a little more sizzle in the air than the frying pan, and the bloggers everywhere, they...
Kathy Lee, she can't even keep company. She can't even keep her mouth shut during this.
Right.
Talked about it. It got like 400,000 hits. Everyone viewing this piece of videotape. So, of course, we had to bring in our etiquette expert, Susan Fitter, to help us out of this mess. And that's
why we didn't have to. We thought it would be funny.
Yes, and she's actually between us, which is a good thing. Wasn't he rude, Susan?
Kathy Lee might have to. Wasn't he rude? She goes.
Yeah.
You know, the bottom line is etiquette in the 21st century is mashed up. We saw it here. It's a good example. It's fun. However, the rules of guests and hosts are kind of clear.
Yes. I never read any rules. I've been in television for 40 years. There are no rules.
Okay, let's use you guys. You guys.
No, there are rules, Kathy Lee. Like, you can't talk over one another. I mean, you try not to. You try and give somebody a little... There's rules in life.
But do you notice this woman started to say there was a responsibility on the part of host, and who pipes in and says, hold it.
Yeah.
There are no rules on me.
Yeah, listen to this. There's no rules because I'm a spoiled child.
Yeah.
See, most children, when they're growing up, are told no, but there were no boundaries for me because I was so wonderful. My mother and father thought every little shit I took was perfect. So there's no rules for me. For other people, yes, but no one can tell me to shut up. Everything I say, my parents thought was great.
Why are you bringing an etiquette expert
right.
if there are no rules? Then what he did was okay.
She won't even let the etiquette expert talk. Do you notice the etiquette?
Yeah, she's having trouble.
Example, the rules for hosts is that you make your guests feel comfortable and appreciated, right?
Yes, which we did.
So sweet to him. But you
Stop talking. Stop talking, Sam. Keep going. Keep going, Susan.
Okay, the rules for the guests are pretty clear, too. You need to be charming, interactive, and respectful.
Can I just say, please, I didn't do anything different that I wouldn't do if it was a group of my friends or my mom or my parents or...
Right.
I don't know where that came. There was just that moment I feel this obligation to the audience.
Right.
To provide the information, and it just wasn't getting through that moment. That's all.
Well, you were entertaining, but were you respectful, interactive, and charming?
No. Okay. But I love you guys. I brought presents.
And we love you, too.
Oh, he has to suck those cows'
tits. That's what happened, yeah. They taught him a lesson.
Yeah. I brought presents. I'm sorry. It's my fault. Why didn't Kathy Lee bring him a present? That fucking bitch! I hate her! He should have brought two big muzzles for those two animals. I brought presents. It's a muzzle, you two dogs. With a ball gag.
That would have been funny. I wish he had pulled out a ball gag.
Yeah. That's what he should have pulled. I love that he has to apologize to these cackling monsters who ruined his segment.
And, of course, the etiquette expert is going along with them.
Yeah.
She doesn't say, but you guys weren't allowing him to speak and present.
Right.
I brought presents. I brought.
This, Sam.
Thank you for shopping at Walmart.
Please. You know what? I think that our etiquette expert.
That's the little smiley guy, isn't it, from Walmart?
Our etiquette expert would say you should accept the gift graciously.
Thank you. And in Chinese, we say, Shesha.
You know, you should probably have one. And our etiquette expert would also say you probably shouldn't talk with your mouth full. Is that right?
Oh, there he goes again.
There he goes again.
It's a joke.
We don't want them to help themselves. Come on, Sam.
Come on. I say you learn from
it. Even during the etiquette segment, they're talking over each other. Yeah. I'm telling you, this is morning television, and this is what women watch. Who do you think sitting at home while their husbands are working watching this crap?
Yes, I'm moving out.
Okay. Stay with us. Susan, please stay with us.
Yes,
please. Please, we want to be gracious and inviting hosts.
I feel us building to a group hug. You guys too?
No.
Start cooking.
Okay. Boundaries, remember?
All right, so here's the deal. A bag of frozen shrimp in your freezer will make a million things at the last minute. Take a handful up, put them in cold water. 15 minutes later, they're ready to go. We're making shrimp BLTs. It's your basic BLT, your basic everyday BLT, but we're going to make it with shrimp.
Okay, good.
You could do this as well with fresh shrimp, couldn't you?
Yes.
Yes, you could.
Kathy Lee's got major attitude. Wow.
That guy has not been back on.
No, he hasn't, right?
He couldn't have been.
Right.
Listen to the way they're treating him.
Oh, they're insulted. You don't tell us to shut up. We were wronged. The one she should have an attitude with is Frank. He was trying to fuck a girl in the ass in a hotel room.
Oh, no, she forgave him.
No, that's no problem. We worked all that out. I'm very Christian. But this poor bastard's trying to make a living. The Sam character with his website. He's on there actually giving people some information. You heard what he said. It was important to me. The guy probably put some work into the segment.
Thinking, you brought me on to show people how to make something. I wanted them to get the information.
And these two cackling yentas who don't even put an ounce of thought into what they do. They don't, you know. They show up at the studio. Kathy Lee doesn't prepare. They prepare everything for her, and she just cackles over it.
She just said, there are no rules for me.
Right. We didn't know there were any rules. Oh, does she aggravate me. Give me 2 more hours on this topic, and I'll be done with it.
Take a break. We'll be back right now.
We'll hear him ask for that unnatural sex act.
Right.
Oh, too bad she didn't say yes.
Oh, man, can you imagine?
With the anal sex?
Oh, man.
Imagine the noises coming out of her. Yeah, Jeff, you're on the air.
Howard, all I can remember is that obnoxious, disgusting Christmas special Kathy Lee had where she goes, don't go
friends.
We got a million friends.
Yeah, you know what's funny, though?
Come on, everybody.
Florence Henderson, I think she knew as soon as she heard my voice that it wasn't me, because she actually was looking at the producers going, that's not Kathy Lee, shaking her head. Mm. And at one point, she even stepped out of the camera shot and leaned forward to tell one of the producers.
She should be a private eye.
Yeah. Well, it was so funny to me. I don't know who you got through to get on the air. That's amazing.
Let me hear that again, the first part. Just a little part, like where you are, Kathy Lee.
Oh, okay, let me rewind it here.
No, like
Frank and I.
Frank and I.
All the Kathy Lee things.
Yeah. And Cody.
And who are Cassidy.
Oh, that's more like it.
Okay.
He says $500.
We're so lucky because Cody and Cassidy are normal and healthy.
You first pledged $500.
Okay, here it is.
That was funny when you pledged $500.
Yeah, because they got disappointed. They didn't want $500 from Kathy.
$500? Honey, you're a millionaire.
Here it is.
Go ahead.
Hello. Yeah, hello.
Who's this?
Hi, this is Kathy Lee Gifford.
Kathy.
Hi.
Hiya, Kathy.
How are you?
Great. We just heard something, Kathy. What did we hear?
Frank and myself are committing to making a $500 pledge to cerebral palsy.
$500 pledge?
$500,000.
Aha! That's what I thought we heard.
Hey, Kathy, this is Jack Houseman.
Hi, Jack.
This is the greatest news we've had. It's just fabulous. Do tell Frank I'm going to play him even in that case.
Okay, well, we're fortunate that Cody and Cassidy are healthy. And I'd even like to make a confession, if I might.
Sure.
I would love to make hot monkey love to Howard Stern.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I don't think this is Kathy Lee.
Well, I don't think so either. I didn't hear it.
That's what I was afraid of. It's really unfortunate to have an
impersonator.
Well, that's bad karma for whoever did it.
Jinx is 30 years old working in a gas station. I think he's got all the best karma you can get.
How much worse can it get?
Well,
the point is that it's a real shame. On Kathy Lee's behalf, we just were with Frank Gifford at the Sherry Netherlands Hotel of the Caprani restaurant just the other day. So that's why we
name dropping.
Had some authenticity. That's why we kept it in such a pause. So we waited for
actually heard it. It's the voice. I was trying to hear the voice before we went on.
Just say it's a phony phone call and get on with it.
This kind of bomb to happen to us, but we'll make a positive out of it. Can you imagine whoever this monkey is that wants to make monkey love to Howard Stern has already...
That's a racial slur.
...love to the devil.
Hey, you know what's funny about that, too?
Yeah.
I was watching the telethon. I didn't get to see that, but... It was, like, so boring, because Florence Henderson was singing every minute, and it was just boring, you know?
Yeah.
If something like that happens, at least it's, you know...
It got them all excited.
It got them $25,000.
They woke up.
I say you're going to have good karma.
Wish somebody would pay me $25,000.
You deserve it.
You know, it was so funny. Like, he talked about it, like, for the
gave him something. It brought him to life. It gave him something. It gave him a purpose. I mean, you know, then the rest of the whole telethon, he's back to, you know, glomming money off of the poor viewers.
Gave him a reason to go through the rest of that telethon.
Right. That was his, you know, his cause. His reason debt.
Oh, dear. Now we're going to have John Ritter on our case.
Yeah.
Do you think that Kathy Lee found out about this?
Oh, I'm sure.
Oh, dear.
Hi, this is Kathy Lee, and I just want to say how fortunate Cody and Cassidy are that they have their health. And Frank and I would love to donate $500.
Heads are going to roll.
Do you think that Kathy Lee will now step forward and make a donation to help fix this?
I believe she will.
I believe not.
I hope she donates until she goes bankrupt. You should have said, no, it's really me.
Hey,
I
Howard.
Really dig Howard Stern.
Hey,
they
Howard.
Probably cut you off immediately after that.
Right.
When you eventually have Kathy Lee on dial date, can I play?
Yes. You can go out with her. Hey, thanks, man. That was pretty wild.
Larry? Hello? Okay, he's on.
We have Larry King calling me on our phone, which should be on the line.
Hello?
Mr. Roof, what do you think of Howard Stern, the radio personality? How do you like them apples?
I don't think we got Larry King, no. I think it was a phony.
Well, you know, we do this show. It's life and death, and it's important, but you're always going to get a schmuck out there.
Schmuck. A monkey.
That's okay. What the hell? It's what makes the world go round.
Jerry.
At least Jerry got out of it.
You win pretty good, folks.
Kevin Jakes had that one on the right speed.
No, it sounds like Jerry's turning into Alvin.
Yeah. Kevin Jakes has been called a schmuck and a monkey. And Florence Henderson has wished bad karma on him. Like, that guy could have worse karma.
If they only knew, they should have a telethon for him.
She's in the karma basement.
He needs a telethon.
You can't threaten a guy like that with bad karma.
You wind up working at a gas station.
Hell's a party compared to his life.
People with CP are in better shape.
There's a guy, 30 years old, can't get laid, makes phony phone calls and works in a gas station and gets fired all the time.
I'm not even positive. I think he's between gigs again.
Is he?
Oh, he got fired from the gas station?
I think he left on his own accord.
I see.
Oh.
You can't have worse karma than that.
Who's now 137 years old. Was he on? Was he a big star?
Oh, yeah. They actually gave Soupy his own spot to come on and beg for money for their children.
You know, I love kids. And kids, when I was, you know, years ago, I used to entertain children.
I have two of my own.
Is that what he said?
Yes. I have two of my own.
Yeah, they're covered in tattoos.
I'm very lucky.
Yeah. Soupy Snail, Civil War veteran.
I have children of my own. I'm very lucky.
Man, he must have been some great dad.
And my grandchildren are all healthy.
But, you know, not all of us is that lucky. So we should all contribute to the Cousin Brucey Fund.
We have that on tape if you want it.
Oh, yeah?
Cousin Brucey and Soupy.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I'd love to hear that.
Funniest thing to me was Soupy, you know, gives his great appeal for the money,
right.
But then he almost forgets to plug himself.
Oh.
And he goes,
Only he does about 10 minutes of plugs.
Where is he? What is Soupy plugging?
In little rooms and restaurants.
Little worse than Jackie rooms.
Oh, really?
lower than Chuckles.
So he's asking for money for himself at the same time he's asking for money for kids.
Right, exactly.
And I'll be at the,
I'll be the treehouse.
Elena's restaurant in Detroit.
Is that right?
Yes. Yeah.
And Brucey had to, like, push him off.
Oh, really?
Like, get out of here already. Enough.
Yeah, because he's giving dates way down the road.
He's not even working comedy clubs anymore. He's working tables at restaurants.
Really?
I'll go get it.
I'm going to be having a meal at an Italian restaurant in a couple of weeks. I'd like you to stop by at my table and say hi.
I stand up and toast you.
Yeah. I'll give you a special blessing. A rabbinical blessing. Soupy sale blessing.
And he told some really bad jokes and nobody laughed.
Oh, is that right?
It was awful, yeah.
Yeah, soupy.
Yeah, Cousin Brucey, this disc jockey here in New York, runs a variety telethon. It's like some telethon for kids. They don't even know what the disease is. Just any, generally just kids. And Kathy Lee Gifford shows up.
Yes, and when they handed off to Kathy Lee, thank you, soupster.
Is that what she said? She is such a crow. You know, when I was laying in bed, I watched that Regis and Kathy Lee every day. And every day I'm sitting there watching it going, I don't believe this.
Yeah.
I can't believe what I'll... This woman is such a vomit. But, you know, she's easy to look at. That's what the whole thing is. I mean, she's an idiot.
Thank you, soupster.
She gets on there. She's evidently somebody sent her a copy of each movie that is Academy Award nominated.
Yeah.
She knows someone who's part of the Academy Awards, right. Like you do.
Yeah.
So Robin knows somebody, too, because I saw Pulp Fiction because of that. Anyway, it seems Kathy Lee had all the Academy Award nominated movies, and she was going to sit at home and watch them because she wants to be well-versed in what's nominated because she is, after all, a broadcaster. So she decides that she's going to watch Pulp Fiction and mm-hmm. give her review the next day. So I go, all right, I'll watch. Let me hear her review. She gets on, she goes, I couldn't watch it. I watched 25 minutes of it, or something like that.
Right.
And I couldn't watch it. It was so negative. I said, what planet did she drop in from? What do you mean negative? Nothing negative about it. I mean, it's the story of, two guys who are, you know, mobsters.
Gangsters, yeah.
But what are you talking about? It's a movie, you nitwit, empty-headed bimbo. And it's like one of the best movies ever.
Yeah.
I just couldn't, you know, there's so much ugliness in the world. Why can't things be pleasant in our film? It's just like, you know, what is she, Mrs. Eisenhower?
Maybe.
I mean, is she completely naive? Where did she grow up? At first when she said she couldn't watch it, I thought she was too stupid to put the tape in the machine. Her and that Frank.
Frank doesn't know about electricity.
Yeah.
Wow.
What do you mean?
12.
Over and over again. And she's on there. Oh, and this Pulp Fiction is terrible. And I just said, who is she? Who is she to give her opinion? Stupid cow. You are so lucky you're good looking. No one would put up with her. And even Regis Philbin can't stand her. You can just see it.
I know. That was, because I watched a couple of their interchanges.
Yeah.
While I was at home during the week, and it's just so obvious that they hate each other.
Yeah, they hate each other. He can't get a word out. She's completely carried away with herself. Yeah. That laugh. She's like, yeah. She's now got. She's forced herself into a new laugh.
Yeah.
Holy mackerel. Yeah. I mean, and if Regis was ever happening, it had to be like 1926. It hasn't been any time recently.
And then she says, oh, and every on the telephone, she says, everybody asks me if Regis is as funny in person as he is on that TV show. And I say he's funnier. You should see him during the commercials.
Oh, boy. Yeah, he's a scream.
Why would he save his funniest stuff for the commercial?
Because he's an imbecile, just like she is. Two nitwits who's saving their best material for the commercials. If he says something funny during the commercials, get back on the air and say it.
Why wouldn't you repeat it?
Because he's a nitwit. And she's as dumb as a wall.
And I constantly heard about this Cody Gifford house.
I know.
When you built Cody Gifford house... Kathy Lee
and Cody.
We have Cody Gifford house.
Can you imagine naming? You know, you're so in love with your little sperm and egg. She has to name all of these houses after. She names these charities after her children. These little spoiled brats who I hope grow up to be heroin addicts. Cody Gifford, I hope, grows up to be a gay heroin addict. So we can prove once and for all what a crummy mother she is. Anyway, I don't want to talk about Kathy Lee.
I'm sorry. I had to bring it up. It suddenly just overcame me. I'm going to get through this without crying this year.
Did she get through it without crying?
She tried to tear up, but the woman started talking happy dog. She couldn't do it. I wondered why my little Cody was born to privilege and health when this AIDS baby was not.
Is that what she said? That bitch. I wish he would have been born with AIDS. I wish he would have been born with incurable AIDS. Why did my Cody get born with incurable AIDS?
It's just not fair.
Yo, let's make it fair. Let's make him have AIDS. That bitch.
And I said to you, are all these babies going to die? And you said yes.
Who said yes?
The woman she was talking to.
Oh.
Who helps over at Cody Gifford House, I suppose.
I'd like to stick some nitroglycerin in her tampon. Put nitro in her tampon and watch her explode.
And you said yes.
Oh, is she a retard? She reminds me of every Pollyanna simpering mother that I had to grow up with when I was a kid. Used to sit there and fawn all over their monsters.
Yeah.
That kid Cody, I hope he grows up to be the monster I think he's going to grow up to be. I really do, because whenever you spoil a kid that much and start naming charity houses after him and you think you're that important as a kid growing up, you become like, you know, Dennis the Menace.
Berserker.
Yeah, Berserker.
That's right, he shaves his head and becomes a skinhead.
Yeah, Berserker. Tattoos Berserker into his head.
Big into his aisle head. In the
whole head. Big aisle. And one day on Geraldo, Kathy Lee will come on, and then Cody will be about 20. And he'll come on, and he'll have a bag on his head, and he'll remove it, and he'll have a skinhead, and he'll have Zig Heil. Sitting across his head.
Hello, Mom.
He'll be like, Mom, I have a secret to tell you. I'm a skinhead. I worship Adolf Hitler.
Oh, right. Mom.
Hitler was right. And, Mom, you're the first Jew I'm going to kill. A big football blows tattooed onto his ass cheek. Because his old man drove him nuts. Cody, don't you think you should play football like I did? Dad, I don't think so, because the guys found out I'm gay. And they want to beat me up.
Yeah, guess what is happening over at Cody Gifford House.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be great if Cody Gifford House turned out to be like a gay front?
Then.
Yeah, a gay crack den. Yeah, like after a couple of years, it kind of falls apart.
Yeah. A little rundown.
Yeah, some of the office workers there are doing crack. And then they sort of gay sex ring.
Really?
Cody Gifford House.
They can see me now.
You know what? I want to talk about Cato Kalin, but I got to take a break.
Okay, I'm sorry. I couldn't hold back.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, I just had to talk about that telethon.
Yeah, that's some telethon. I missed it. We'll be back right after this.